You want to invest now. What can you do?
Welcome to today's Bursa Secrets webinar. Thank you everyone for tuning in so early. And we have already just two minutes in with some videos, advertisement, etc. And already 160 of you tuning in. Hello everyone. If you can hear us well, type in hi, right? I'm super excited. I think it's been a long time since I'm so excited because there's a lot of first time, right? Today also, we have a special guest with us here, Mr. John from FIRL. I think some of you may have come, you know, across his video on YouTube before. If you come across his video on YouTube before, type in FIRL, right? So John actually has a channel with his partner where they talk a lot about stocks, and maybe later I'll let him introduce himself. But for those that are new, if this is the first time you see me, my name is Ming Teck. I'm the CEO and founder of Savvy Investment, where we teach people how to start investing from zero. So if that's what you're looking for, you can come to my website, www.bursasecrets.com, and register for a free webinar. Well, actually, quite a few of them heard of you, you know, John. Maybe you can give some introduction about yourself.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. Actually, it's first for me. First time I'm hosting in Ming Teck, someone I look up to as well. My name is John. I'm the co-founder of FIRL, and we help 20 to 30-year-olds build a 6 to 7-figure portfolio from scratch. Yeah. So, you know, it's going to be very exciting tonight, right, Ming Teck? Because we have almost the entire management team of HIBISCS. You know, I think it's a first for you to host so many important people as well.
Yep. And I think this is also one of the bigger companies. So yeah. I'm very excited because I myself, sometimes I trade oil stocks, and HIBISCS is from the surface, because I don't know much about oil and gas. You should know more than me because you have been in the industry. It looks like very good to me, you know. So that's why sometimes I trade it before. And I don't understand why, you know, it's selling so cheap. So maybe there is something that, you know, we need to understand more about.
That's right. Okay. That's right.
So today, we have a really, really powerful roster. I think the top management are all here. So maybe I'll introduce them one by one, and I'll bring them up to say a hi. So guys, help us press a share button for this video, because I think this video will be super powerful. You can ask questions at the end. This is the rare opportunity for you to engage with the management. So tag your friend that are invested in oil and gas stock. People don't understand why oil and gas stock is so high. Sorry, the oil price is so high, but the oil and gas stock is not performing well. So let's see if there's, you know, special opportunity. And special thanks to Rondi for, you know, connecting us up. So yes. The first person that I'll introduce is Dr. Kenneth Pereira, who is the managing director.
Good evening, everyone. Hi, Ming Teck. Hi, John. Hello.
Hi, Dr. Kenneth.
Yep. Then I'll also introduce the CFO, Mr.
Hi, good evening, everyone.
Mr. Yip.
Hi, good evening. Hi, John. Hi, Ming Teck.
Hi, Mr. Yip. Good evening.
And then Dr. Pascal Oronia. This is the first time I'm managing so many people. I need to find. Yeah. Dr. Pascal. Okay.
All right. Hi, good Dr. evening, Pascal. Ming Teck, John. Hi, good evening, everybody.
Hi, Doctor.
Dr. Good evening. Pascal. He's the senior vice president, and he's in charge of new ventures. Next, I'll introduce Joyce, who is the head of corporate finance. Right, hold on.
Hello, everyone. Good to meet you.
Hi. Yeah.
Good evening, Joyce.
So, guys, it's a very good opportunity for you to ask questions later. So, if your questions, you know, is relevant, it's like you're going to hospital. There's a specialist for everything. So if your question touch on certain subject, the specialist will be answering later. Then we also have Deepak Thakur, who is the Vice President of Economics and Business Planning. So Deepak.
Hello, everyone. Hello, Meg. Hello, John. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too, Deepak.
Wow, I think in the comment there, you know, somebody is saying, wow, big team. Yeah, man. I think you should be very honored. The whole team.
Mengtek, this is like the whole hospital, you know. You're not going to see one specialist. You're seeing the orthopedic, oncologist, pediatrician, all one shot, you know. So.
yep. And then also, we have Dr. Wayne Chan, who is a vice president of New Energy Ventures.
Hi, everyone. Hi, John. And hi, Mengtek. Good to see you all.
Yeah.
Good to see you. And you look sharp today.
Yes, very sharp.
Okay. Last but not least, we have Lily Ling, who actually organized this session for us, right? Who is a senior general manager of corporate development.
Hi. Thanks, of course, to John, Mengtek, and also Rondi for hosting us. Welcome, everyone.
Yeah. So we are going to start the presentation soon. But first of all, I need to say, you know, thank you for the overwhelming response. We have already 360 of you live. And I expect, you know, the numbers to go up from here. And also thanks for your help. Right, type in super if you are very impressed with today's roster of management. I think they are very, what do you say, very sincere in sharing their plan today. So keep all your questions. And then around half an hour later, let's keep them coming, right? You can grill, right? Any question you want to ask, bring them forward. So let me invite Dr. Kenneth again, the managing director, to share with us, right, a small presentation that's already been prepared so that we can get a good idea on what HIBISCS is all about. Then after that, we can ask whatever questions we want one by one. All right, so Dr. Kenneth, over to you.
Thank you, Mengtek. Thank you, John. And thank you for hosting HIBISCS today. I think good evening to all members of the audience. And, you know, thank you for spending your Friday evening with us. And truly, we are very honored to bring the team together to do a little presentation for yourselves. We understand that we will be addressing a wide range of audience today, some people with prior knowledge of the company and the industry, and some people maybe not so much. So we are going to start, I'm going to start my presentation with a couple of very, let's say, high-level slides just to kind of break down the industry. And then after I just talk about that, we will go into the HIBISCS petroleum story, what HIBISCS is today. I will hand off to part three to Dr. Pascal. He will talk about the recent acquisition that we made of some assets in Malaysia, owned by an international company called Repsol. And Dr. Weenie will speak about our what we call the energy transition strategy. Everybody in this in on the planet today actually is talking about green energy, green initiatives, renewable energy, all these type of words, all these buzzwords. We'll talk a little bit about our plans in this area. And Dr. Weenie will lead that discussion. And towards the end, maybe I'll say a few words, or Joyce might say a few words just to close off the presentation. And like we said, please add type in your questions whenever you want. Andrew, if you can, take us to the first slide, which would be the Let me just cover this slide very quickly, and what it is it shows an industry structure, the Malaysian oil and gas industry structure, but it's valid for any part of the world. It's just that in this structure, we have filled it up with a few names in Malaysia that you would recognize. So sometimes you will hear about something called the upstream oil and gas sector. Sometimes you'll hear something called the downstream oil and gas sector. And then if you're in industry, you'll also hear about the midstream business. So here, what we try to do is just try to kind of have allow you to have in your mind what we are talking about and what is exactly happening in each of these different sectors of the business. So firstly, let's talk about upstream. In the upstream business, and HIBISCS is very definitely in Malaysia, probably the only listed pure play oil and gas E&P player, what we call. We are looking for oil. We are exploring where we don't explore so much these days. We used to, but we develop oil fields. We produce oil fields, and we are in the upstream sector. alongside us, we are the smallest player amongst the, some of the names we see here, but companies like ExxonMobil, Petronas Carigali, Shell, Repsol, Murphy Oil, these are companies, PTTEP from Thailand. These are companies that you would have heard doing the same type of business as we do. So a company like EnQuest is in Malaysia. Sapura Energy is a little bit of a hybrid. They are in the upstream business. They are in the what we call the exploration and production sector. Yes, they are in that. They are also in the services business. And I will talk about the services business in 2 minutes. In the midstream business, you would have heard of a company, very large company called MISC. They are a subsidiary of Petronas. And their job is to move oil. They move oil from the oil fields or from the refineries. They move oil to where the oil is required. They might move it from an oil field to a refinery or from a refinery to a petrol station. So MISC does that type of activities. They have ships that move this type of cargoes of oil. And they are in the midstream business. And their main business is transporting oil. They transport LNG or liquefied natural gas. So MISC is in this part of the business. And then there are the downstream players. They are doing refining, processing. Shell is in that business. Petron, where you go and take your petrol from in the petrol station. BHP, Bausted Holdings, these are the companies, and of course Petronas, Dagangan, and you see all the Petronas petrol stations. This is the downstream part of the business, and you will, if you go to Kerteh, you will see refineries there. You go to Port Dickson, or you go to Malacca, you will also see refineries there. And of course, you would know one of the biggest projects recently was in Johor, in Pengerang, and that's also a very, very large processing facility and refinery. So this is generally the industry structure. You have upstream, midstream, downstream. Supporting the companies that are active in the upstream, midstream, and downstream are a group of service companies. Here you're talking about Petra, you're talking about Uzma, you're talking about Dayang, you're talking about Dialog, you're talking about Bumi Amada. All of these companies, and then you have the international players like Halliburton, Petrofac, Schlumberger. All of these companies, and of course, recently, Serba Dynamic has been in the news, but they are also a service company. And all of these companies are supporting the companies in the upstream, midstream, downstream. So these are called oil field services companies or oil service companies. And on the other side, on the left-hand side of this chart, these are called oil companies, or if you're in the midstream, you're a refining company. And I think that's really how the industry is broken up. For the longest time in Malaysia, on Bursa Malaysia, we had mostly service companies. But since HIBISCS, since Reach Energy a little bit, and then and some of the business of Sapura, we are also getting oil companies into Bursa Malaysia. So I think that's roughly what this structure is, industry structure looks like. It's valid for all parts of the world, but the companies that might be players in each part of the world are different. So that's a little bit about what this slide is about. Now, if we move on to the next slide, this tells you a little bit about where we operate, actually, and where our assets are and in the life cycle of an oil field. So if you look at this chart, let's start from the very top of the chart. You will see certain words there in those yellowish, goldish boxes, exploration, development, production. And then we have the last box, decommissioning. This is a life cycle of an oil field. And let's say from the beginning to the end could be, for a very small oil field, maybe 5 to 6 years. But for a very large oil field, can be maybe 30, 40, 50 years, can be even longer, okay? So this is the time is on the x-axis. It can be a very long period for a large field, and it can be, even for a small field, it would probably be about six, seven years, actually, by the time from the start to the end of a small field. So these are long-term investments, okay? And if you look at this chart, if you move down, to the next line, you will see something saying high geological risk, and then it's moving towards the right. As you move from the start of the project, like any project, when anything starts, you have high geological risk. And then as you get on throughout the life of the project, the risk level will actually reduce. So this is what is happening even in our industry. When we start off on a project, we are actually having high geological risk. When we say high geological risk, what we're saying is we are not sure what is underground. We are looking for oil. We're not sure what is underground. We've got some information. We've got some data that we have collected, but we are not sure what is there. So that in that phase, we say we have high geological risk. But after we do a lot of studies, analysis, we drill some wells, we take some data, etc., we find some oil possibly, or sometimes you find oil which are not in commercial quantities. But what happens is you then slowly, if you have commercial quantities, you start developing that oil field. You're moving to the right. You get to a point where, you know, you are having to develop field. You develop the oil field. You're having to build platforms. You will see some videos later about what we do offshore, what the platforms look like. At that point, there is a risk of cost because you're doing things offshore. You're doing complicated things. So there is a cost risk. And then once you already have the oil in production, then what you're doing is you're taking oil price risk. At that point, you're looking at every day, like what I do every morning. First thing I wake up, I look at what is the oil price for today. Okay, so you start looking at what is the oil price, because now you're producing something, you're producing a commodity, and you want to know that you are actually, you're in an environment where the price that you can sell at is higher than your cost. So what we have done on this chart is you can see we have certain names, Vic P57, you see Vic P74, you see Marigold. These are names of our fields in different parts of the world and where they are in the current life, in their life cycles. So we have some fields in Australia. We are not doing very much there. They are in what we call the exploration phase. We are not exploring there. We're not spending money right there, over there. But then you see, as you move to the right, we have a field called Marigold. There we are. There's oil already been found, and we are looking at how we can develop that so that we can bring in some production. And then we have, when you move on, you have our to the right, you will see our assets, Anasuria and the North Sabah PSC. These are production assets. They are producing oil. They're producing together about 9,000 barrels a day of oil. So these are generating cash for us. And the recent asset that we bought from Repsol is also in this area. It is an asset that's also in production. Actually, it's producing twice as much as we are producing right now. And Dr. Pascal later will tell you more about this asset. And as we, when you look at this chart, what it also shows is as we go along this life cycle, what our investment looks like. You know, you're early on in an oil field, you may not be spending so much. During the late exploration phase and into the development phase, like where Marigold is now, you are investing because you're putting infrastructure offshore. Most likely for us, it's offshore. There could also be projects onshore, but for us, it's offshore. And then when you're going into the production phase, it is mostly about maintenance, regular maintenance of the equipment and all of that. So the expenditure then reduces. And then finally, at the end of the oil field, you may have to do some cleanup activities. You have to decommission the field. So there might be some investment at that point in time. You will see one little bit of an anomaly towards the end of the life of the field. You will see a kind of a gray bar that's looking a little bit out of place towards the end of the life of the field there. And that one is basically saying, as you get towards the end of the life of a field, there may be one or two opportunities that you didn't look at earlier on. You might look at them very late in the life of the field, and then that gives you some additional production towards the end. And that's why directly after that, you see one of the yellow bars is kind of increasing a little bit kind of sticking out there. So that's kind of the story of an oil field. And like I said, from left to right, this can be maybe 50 years in time. So, you know, companies in our business, it's long-term investments. It might be large investments up front, but the benefits are long-term. We take always a long-term view, okay? I think that's really what I'm saying about this slide. Can we move on to the next slide, please? Thank you. So now I'll talk a little bit, a few slides about the company today. So HIBISCS was listed on Bursa in 2011. We listed as a SPAC, but very soon afterwards, we made an acquisition and we are now just a normal oil and gas E&P company listed on the main market. Market cap point of view, we are about 1.4 billion, 1.3, 1.4 billion type market cap with more than 25,000 shareholders. That's how we are as a listed company. We are in the, as I said, we are in the oil and gas exploration and production business. And, you know, if you look at the graph on the bottom left-hand side, what you see is how our market capitalization of the company tracks oil price. So the black line there is oil price, is the Brent oil price. And as you can see, the red line is our market capitalization, which basically reflects our share price. And you can see it tracks it quite, there's a good correlation. Towards the middle right-hand side of this chart, you will see we talk about something called our 2P reserves, and we put a number there, 45.8 million barrels. Reserves basically refer to oil in the ground, which we have the infrastructure and is basically what we are able to produce without too much trouble. We keep our equipment well maintained. We do some work, we do some little bit of investment around the asset. And we are able to produce about these number of barrels. So combined with our Anasuria and our North Sabah asset, we are sitting at about 45.8 million barrels in terms of reserves. And what are we doing? Every year we are producing about 3 million barrels. So this is about 15 years of future reserves that are already discovered and producible. So if we continue producing at the same rate as we are producing today, we have got about 15 years of reserves in the ground, which we can produce. So that is the source of our future cash flows. Just next to that number is a number called our resources, our 2C resources. This is our proven and probable contingent resources, meaning to say we have found oil on certain fields, but we have to make some investments or we have to get some permits, government permits or some approvals, or we might have to do a little bit more of both, working on some investments, some permitting. We got to do some of this stuff before we can get this into production. You know, investments, permitting sometimes can take a while. So this is what we have in the ground in reserve. Okay. So that's almost in the property world, you will call this your land bank. It is something not generating cash flow for you today, but it is promising you a sustainable future. It's basically saying you're still going to have a business for some years to come. So 45.8 million barrels, okay, of reserves, which means we continue producing 3 million every year, which is what we're doing now. We will continue going for 15 years, okay, at current oil prices. In fact, even at lower oil prices, we'll continue doing that. And then we also have a further 87.7 million barrels of contingent resources. This is telling you that we have got effectively a land bank in the ground, which is our future. It means that the company has growth potential. If we invest some money or we get some permitting or we spend some time on some technical work, we are able to get this into production. Okay. So I think those are kind of the main things I want to say on this slide. Just to say that we are also in three countries. We have producing assets in Malaysia and in the United Kingdom. We have won many awards from Petronas for operational performance, safety performance. We have won safety awards in the UK. As a company, we have we are net cash, so not carrying any debt at all. And throughout our history, our 10-year history, very seldom have we actually drawn down on any facilities. We have facilities, but we try to do as much as we can, you know, from operating cash flows. Looking down, on the next slide, just to kind of show, this is our board and our key management team. You will see on our board, we have a very small board, but a lot of experience on the board. Zainul Rahim, ex-Shell deputy chairman, was a director on the board of Petronas Carigali, and then he's the chairman of HIBISCS, and also a petrophysicist, a technical an engineer by training. Mike Taylor, also an engineer by training, but started his life in Shell as an engineer, but then moved to the finance area and was a regional finance director for Shell. Very, very senior in Shell when he left. Dr. Zarina and Dr. Roshan from the banking industry. Dr. Zarina previously was also in Besar Malaysia. And then myself, also an engineer by training, previously with a company called Schlumberger, then Sapura, and now HIBISCS. You can see also our management team, a very diverse group of people from very, very, some large companies, some small companies, some service companies, many people in this team come from, you know, have multiple qualifications, very, very wide experience. And you can have a look at their CVs also at the on our website or on our annual report. But the co-founders of the team, Pascal and Joyce, are here today on this call. Deepak is on the call. Dr. Weenie is on the call. A lot of many years of experience in this team. Many of us have been working together for most of the life of HIBISCS, actually. So the team has now got a very, very good working chemistry and really a lot of in-depth knowledge of the regional and international oil and gas business. Moving on. This is a little bit about our shareholder base. And many times I tell people this. I think there are not many companies in Malaysia like this. We are a company with no controlling shareholder. The management team is the largest shareholder. We are about 9% of the company. There is a UK-listed company, Polo Investments. They hold 6.9%. Principal Asset Management own about 7%. And then we are all spread. Everybody else is below 5%. So we have corporate and institutional shareholders holding about 37%, and the rest is retail. And that gives us, because of the influence and the holding of the retail shareholders. And that is why we take a lot of time on these type of presentations, making sure that we update the retail shareholders. You can see collectively the retail shareholders are our largest group of shareholders. So we take a lot of time to kind of make sure that the retail part of the shareholding really understand our business and understand what we're doing. You can see that we have a reasonably good average daily trading volume. We're trading about 28 million shares a day. And that, you know, at 66 cents, we're talking about maybe 17 to 18 million ringgit a day of trades. And we've built up a valuation today of about 1.3 billion. Okay, so we think we are probably... there are not many companies in Malaysia that are not family owned or multinational or GLC. So very few. I don't think there are many companies where the largest shareholder is only 9%. Okay, so that's so what we are saying here is the shareholder base is extremely spread. Nobody is cornered the share. It is actually a share that reflects what the market thinks it's worth. That's really where it is today. These are some of the, kind of ESG achievements. We are on the FTSE4Good index. We spend a lot of time making sure that we are on this index. for some of you who don't know what this is about, Bursa Malaysia has tied up with the FTSE people from the UK. And what they do every year is they have a look at all the companies on Bursa. They will look at your sustainability statement. They look at your annual report. They look at your website. They ask you questions. And then they decide whether you can, they are willing to put you on their ESG index, or, you know, their environmental, social and governance index. And a lot of funds will only invest in you if you have got some kind of ESG rating. There are less than 100 companies in Malaysia with on the FTSE for Good index. We are one of them. There are some other companies that are there, like Yinsen and all these guys, but not too many in the oil and gas space. Okay, so we are one of the few. And apart from the FTSE for Good index, which we work very hard to kind of maintain, we are also what we call a Green Lane Policy Qualified Company by Bursa Malaysia. And we have had some very good ratings by Bursa Malaysia for our corporate governance and corporate governance disclosures. Green Lane Policy means that Bursa Malaysia allow us to do certain corporate exercises without having to go back to them for approvals. We can work with an investment bank and issue the documents to shareholders. Then the MSWG, which is the Minority Shareholders Watchdog Group in Malaysia, they're always watching for governance issues in companies. They have rated us in the top 5% of Bursa companies for corporate disclosure and performance. Okay, so we work very hard at ensuring there's a lot of disclosure. And and that was in 2019. They also gave us a rating of top 10% for corporate disclosure in the ASEAN, in the ASEAN index. And that's been slowly, you know, we've been slowly climbing up. We work very hard at this each year, actually. And, you know, in 2018, we were in the top 12%, then we got into the top 10%. And for overall corporate governance, disclosure and performance, we are in the top 5%. So these are some of the things we are proud about in terms of the company. You know, trying to make sure that we have as much transparency as possible. Okay. Yeah, this is a little map. I've kind of mentioned it already, but what it's doing here is it's just saying, you know, where our assets are. So we are in Sabah. We have the North Sabah, what we call the North Sabah EOR, which stands for Enhanced Oil Recovery Production Sharing Contract. It's a producing asset. We operate that asset, and Petronas Carigali is our partner. When we say we operate an asset, it means that we are managing this asset. We have a 50% participating interest in this, so we have 50% participating interest. You know, we because of the taxation system in the country, we differentiate between equity interest, participating interest, and all these things. So we participate 50%. And here we break down what our reserves are. Our 2P, our proven and probable reserves, is about 24.8 million barrels. That I think was effective 1st January this year. And then we have also contingent resources, about 21 million, so 23 million, I think, yeah. So, and the same, we have broken it down for the UK in Anasuria. We've got a producing asset in Anasuria. We've got the Anasuria cluster, which is producing. We've got the Marigold and Sunflower cluster, which is in development. So if you remember our chart, the second chart, we said certain assets are in certain phases of their life cycle. So Marigold is in development, Crown is in development, Teal West is in development. So we've got a bunch of future growth coming in 2023, Marigold probably, Teal West as well. So we've got a bunch of opportunities. This is our future, and that's why we're excited about what we're doing. In Australia, we have some assets. We mentioned them before too, but these assets are not we have a development asset, but we are not exactly spending money there right now. We have exploration assets and we're not doing any exploration right now. So that's the status of our assets around the world. And recently, of course, Pascal will be speaking about it. We made an acquisition in Malaysia and in about 6 months' time, we hope this chart will be a little bit more busy with the new acquisition as well. that new acquisition, there are oil fields in both Peninsula and East Malaysia. Okay. Next slide, please. Okay, so just to introduce, we have got two videos, one on North Sabah, the North Sabah assets that we have. It's about 30, 45 seconds long. And then we have another one on Anasuria. And after that, I think Dr. Pascal will start walking you through the Repsol asset. So enjoy the videos for a couple of minutes, and then Dr. Pascal will come online. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll come back again towards the end. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ken. I'm going to now take you through our recent announced acquisition of the Repsol assets. I'm just going to spend a few slides and telling you exactly what it is that we acquired. So I think Ken mentioned it already. To us, this is a transformative acquisition. Yeah, and I hope after these slides you appreciate why that is. So what are we actually acquiring? It's a corporate transaction. Yeah. So what that means is we're buying a company that is currently still owned by Repsol. And we're taking this top-level company. And that company holds the equity interest in a number of different PSCs in Malaysia and in Vietnam. Yeah. So you can see there's four PSCs, actually three PSCs in Peninsula Malaysia. I can already mention one PSC, the Kinabalu oil PSC in Sabah. And then there's Block 46 PSC, which is in Vietnam. Okay. And I'll tell you how they actually tie together in a little bit. What's interesting about this and what's important to us about this is that up until now, Hibiscus has been very much oil focused. Yeah, so most of our production comes from oil in Anasuria and in North Sabah. But this acquisition, we're adding quite a bit of gas production to our portfolio. Yeah. Gas is it's a very important fuel for the future. Yeah, it is part of the transition to a cleaner future. So it's important for us to start adding more gas to our portfolio. What makes the PM3 concession also very strategic is that it's called CAA. That stands for commercial area commercial area arrangement. And that is because it lies right on the border between Malaysia and Vietnam. So it's actually governed by both Malaysia and Vietnam. And the gas that is produced from this asset goes to both Malaysia and to Vietnam. And as at this point, it actually produces roughly 70% of all the gas used in southern Vietnam. Yeah. So it's quite important. Now, what I mean with a corporate transaction, it also comes with all the Malaysian staff and management. So we're taking over an entire company with its existing balance sheet, assets, and expertise in people. Okay, next slide. To give you a bit of an overview of the size of this this acquisition. Yeah, so all in all, we're going to be operating all these assets going forward. We're talking roughly 17 platforms. There's two floating storage and offloading vessels. Floating storage and offloading vessel is another way to sell your oil. I think in the video you saw that North Sabah produces its oil to a terminal, an oil terminal in Labuan, and the oil is sold from there. In this case, for the PM3 CAA PSC, the oil is produced to these vessels and it is actually sold from the FSO vessels directly to customers. All in all, there's 205 wells in total. So it's a very sizable asset. On the bottom of the chart, you'll see some pictures of all the facilities that we will be operating going forward. There's quite a number of fields that feed into these facilities. Yeah, so the PM3 CAA and Block 46, which sits just across the border, they all feed into the PM3 CAA facilities. There is a whole host of fields. Of course, what's very interesting to us is one of the fields is called the Bunga Raya, which is very nice since we're called Hibiscus. The PSCs called PM305 and 314 are also in Peninsula Malaysia. However, they are at the end of their field life. So they are currently in the process of being abandoned. And the fields in the PSCs are not producing themselves anymore. However, there is one field that sits partly in the PM305 PSC, but it belongs to a neighboring PSC. So that field is what's called the unitized. So essentially the part of the production from that field actually belongs to the PM305 PSC, and we get revenue from that. Okay, so that is still an ongoing operation. And then last but not least is the 2012 Kinabalu PSC. Now this is a primarily oil producing asset in Sabah, very close to Labuan. And it also produces its oil into the Labuan crude oil terminal, which we operate already. Okay, next slide. Some of you may have seen the announcement. So we announced that we are purchasing these assets of this company from Repsol for $212.5 million. So you may be wondering, I think Ken has already mentioned, we're a debt-free company. We're net cash at this moment. So you're wondering how we are funding this asset. Now, there's two parts. There's a number of parts to this. But first of all, when we buy this company, we put in an offer based on an effective date, which means we said that we were buying this effectively 1st January 2021. So that means that all the cash that's in the company in January 2021, plus all the cash that's been generated from January 2021 until we actually take over, which we aim to do by the end of this year, also belongs to Hibiscus. Yeah? So there's quite a bit of cash in the company that we can use to pay for this part of the $212.5 million. On top of that, if you remember on one of the first slides when Ken was talking about the introduction to the company, we've placed an instrument called CRPS. These are preference shares in October last year. And we raised about 197.7 million ringgit at that point in time. Yeah, that is cash that's currently sitting in a trust account that we can use for an acquisition such as this. So we'll be able to access $47.8 million in order to pay down the 212 as well. Now, on top of that, we're currently looking at a few options to actually raise some debt to pay down the difference. Okay. Now, we also, of course, as you saw, we have two producing assets. And at the current oil prices, those two assets are generating quite a bit of funds. So we also have additional funds in the group to be able to pay this consideration. Yeah. And if in the end there's still a shortfall, we also still have more CRPS that we can place in the market in order to pay down the final bit of this consideration. What's important to understand is that we have absolutely no intention to raise funds via rights issue. Yeah, because as you can see, we have more than enough sources of funding at this point in time. Okay, next slide. So I mentioned in the beginning that we see this as a transformative acquisition. Now, this slide will show you exactly why. Yeah. If you look at the chart on the top left of this slide, this shows you on the left bar, it shows you what is our current production rate. Yeah, so Hibiscus is currently producing about 9,000 barrels of oil per day. 2,400 barrels of this comes from the Anasaria cluster, and 6,600 barrels comes from North Sava PSC. Okay, these are net numbers to the company. Now, in terms of just pure oil production, with the Repsol acquisition, that number will go from 9,000 to 18,500. Yeah, so it's more than double. If you move to the right, you remember I told you that this asset does not just produce oil, it also produces quite a bit of gas. And if you convert the volumes of gas to an oil equivalent, yeah, then that number goes from 18,500 all the way up to 26,800 barrels net to Hibiscus. Yeah, so you can see that's an almost 3 times increase in the production from today. The same story holds for the number of barrels in the ground. Okay, so our reserves. We currently have about 46 million barrels, or 47 if you add a little bit of gas in Anasaria. And that number goes all the way up to 67 million barrels, or if you add in the gas, 81 million barrels of oil equivalents going forward. Yeah, so almost close to doubling. Now, what's interesting is that 5 years ago, we set ourselves a mission to reach, by this year, 2021, to reach 20,000 barrels of oil per day in production and to have 100 million barrels of 2P reserves in the ground. So we're quite excited that we did exceed the targets that we set for ourselves in terms of production by the time we closed this transaction. And we're very, very near to achieving the reserves figures as well. Yeah, so we're currently working on setting ourselves new targets for the next 5 years, which we'll announce to the markets sometime soon. Okay. So you've seen the numbers or the increases in terms of barrels and in terms of reserves. But what does this mean in terms of our cash flows? So we just take a snapshot for the next 5 years. Yeah. So the expected cash flows to be generated over the next 5 years net to Hibiscus is in the range of $255 million from Repsol alone. Yeah. So that's more than 1 billion ringgit. In terms of EBITDA, we're looking at somewhere around 558.8 million ringgit addition for calendar year 2022. Okay. So if you compare that to, say, the last two reported EBITDA numbers for the last two fiscal years, if you look at the fiscal year 2020, so our fiscal year ends on the 30th of June. Yeah, so 30 June 2020, we reported 213.3 million ringgit EBITDA. For the last three quarters, so ending 31st March 21, that number was 250.9 million ringgit due to slightly improving oil prices over the last 6 months. Now, as I mentioned, adding the Repsol assets based on the current oil prices, that will add 558.8 million ringgit to our EBITDAs. And that is more than double of what we were announcing previously. So it's a very significant acquisition for us. It's going to generate quite a bit of cash flow for us. Now, what is this money going to be used for? Part of it is going to be used to reinvest into our existing assets. One of the things that we're very good at as an oil company that manages mid to late life assets is we find opportunities within these older fields to actually increase production. Now, to do that, you have to invest money. You have to drill more wells. You have to put some more facilities in place. So we do that continuously. Primarily, we do that from existing cash flows from the assets. But it's also going to give us access to funds to buy more assets around the region. So we're looking very much into acquiring additional assets in especially the Asia Pacific region. And last but not least, and this is important, is to continue to pay dividends to our shareholders. So we issued our first dividend earlier this year, and we hope, as long as the oil prices stay as good as they are, to continue doing that going forward. Okay, just to list some of the some other benefits of this acquisition. So I already mentioned almost 50% of the production is gas, which gives a much balance to our portfolio. And it also helps us transition to a more greener business. Dr. Rini will talk a lot more about what else we're doing in that space. We're also going to gain more expertise in operating different types of assets. Now we're going to operate all these assets. And this is the first time we're going to operate a gas-specific asset. Okay. And last but not least, we've already been working with Petronas and Petronas Carigali, as Ken mentioned. And in Malaysia, we've built quite a good reputation with our operations. But now we're expanding that to working with another national oil company, which is PetroVietnam Exploration Production Corporation. And we hope to build on that reputation and gain more opportunities elsewhere in Southeast Asia. Okay. All right, so last but not least, so first of all, I want to say we've been very careful in terms of our acquisitions. Now we've always planned them carefully. They've always been timed just right in terms of where oil price was. And we've managed to enhance the previous assets significantly. So the first acquisition in the UK, the producing asset in the UK was the Anasaria cluster. After we took it over, we enhanced production quite a bit from the previous operator, which was Shell and Exxon. We did a very similar thing to North Sabah. So by buying that asset from Shell and Exxon, kind of gave us an entry back into our home country when Shell was selling the North Sabah PSC. And Shell put us forward to Petronas as one of the potential buyers. And in the end, we were the winning bidder. Now, since we took over the operatorship in March of 2018, we've significantly enhanced production. Previously, it was declining, and it's gone up significantly since then. And now we hope to do the same thing with our Repsol acquisition. Okay. A little bit about the growth of the company. So Ken mentioned in the very beginning, we started the company with three people. And we've grown very steadily through the years. So after we, just before we acquired the UK assets, we only had about 36 people in the company. And we then took on quite a number of Shell staff that came with the Anasaria acquisition. We then assimilated them into the company and slowly grew a little bit more. And then we acquired North Sabah. Again, we took on about 245 Shell people, which then, of course, also were integrated into the company. So currently we have somewhere around 500 to 530 staff in the company, and we're going to be completely transformed after we take over or complete the current acquisition. We'll be more than 1,200 staff. And it's not just warm bodies. These are all people with specific expertise, and they're all essentially expand the knowledge in the company and expand the opportunity for us as a company going forward. Okay, I'm gonna leave you with that here. You can ask me more questions later, which I'm sure you will. And I'm gonna hand it over to Dr. Weenie.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pascal. And good evening, everyone. And again, I hope that you're all doing well. But before I talk about the energy transition, I would like to start off with the sustainability policy of HIBISCS. Yeah, sustainability is a topic of relevance. And the recent COVID-19 pandemic has called for companies, including the oil and gas, to strengthen their sustainability policy, especially with regards to the environment and the social elements. So as you can see from the slide here, HIBISCS policy, sustainability policy, actually spans over three pillars of ESG. And these pillars in turn support 11 out of the 17 UN SDG goals that are set by the UNFCCC. Now, this year is a milestone year for HIBISCS. As mentioned by Dr. Ken, we were listed in 2011. So this is our 10th year. So moving on to our next chapter, HIBISCS would want to align our future by responding to the UN's call for a decade of action to achieve the global sustainability as development goals. Now, I'm not sure how many of you are aware, but today is actually a very special day in terms of the climate agenda for Malaysia, because the Malaysian government actually submitted our very first nationally determined contribution to the UNFCCC, in which Malaysia this time round, we have actually upped our emission reduction target. Now, I will not tell you what is it, but I think it's something that you can find out in your own spare time, yeah? So going back to this slide, specifically under the environmental pillar, our sustainability policy has given much emphasis on the climate agenda. And this is in response to the global call to address climate change. Now, with regards to the climate change, there are essentially two parts of climate change we need to address. Now, first is to reduce the cause of climate change. And this involves reducing global GHG emissions and transitioning towards a future of cleaner energy mix. And essentially, this is what energy transition is all about. You know, the objective of energy transition are to reduce the cost of climate change and to reshape the future fuel mix. Now, the second part of the climate change involves reducing the impact of climate change. Now, since 2017, the global average temperature increase has reached 1 degree Celsius above the pre-industrial levels. And in that regards, it is inevitable that we will experience the effects of climate change. Hence, climate adaptation will be an important aspect for any business to address, yeah? So this slide basically explains how the energy transition strategy of HIBISCS fits into the broader sustainability policy. Next slide, please. Right, with regards to the energy transition for an E&P company, an important aspect to create is a resilient portfolio of assets. Now, traditionally, HIBISCS has oil assets. The proposed acquisition of Repsol is significant, as mentioned by Dr. Pascal, in that for the first time, we're going to have gas in our portfolio. But why is gas important in energy transition? Now, according to a recent report by IRENA, by 2050, electricity will be the main carrier with over 50% direct share of total final energy use, which is up from 21% today. And not only that, by 2050, 90% of total electricity generation will be supplied by renewables, of which 63% comes from solar and wind. Now, solar and wind belong to a family of renewables, which we have termed as variable renewable energy. Their intermittency nature is an issue for the electricity grid to manage. And up to this juncture, gas is the only cost-viable solution to manage this variability. Hence, gas will have an important role to play as a bridging fuel in the energy transition until such time as the cost of batteries and other solutions reach commercial viability.
Now, to this end, the increase in gas in our proposed acquisition is really the heart of HIBISCS energy transition strategy. Now, aside from creating a resilient portfolio, our energy transition, as you can see from the slide here, it actually consists of two key pillars. The first pillar is on decarbonization. Essentially, this involves reducing our carbon footprint. As a first step, we have recently included our aspiration to be a net zero emissions producer in our mission statement. And additionally, Anasuria Operating Company, the operator of the Anasuria cluster, has also committed to a net zero policy. And in fact, you can access this policy from their website. Now, HIBISCS has operating assets in both the UK and Malaysia. And these two net zero declarations actually align with the net zero policy of both UK, as well as the net zero aspirations set by Petronas. Now, aside from what we have publicly declared, we are also in the progress of establishing our emissions reduction target. And this will include an interim and the long-term targets and developing strategies to decarbonize our assets. And lastly, our decarbonizing efforts will include establishing synergy with our key partners, such as the government, regulators, the industry partners, and also those in our supplier chain. Now, the second pillar is on investment diversification. And climate change presents opportunities for investment diversification. And this is really evident among the oil companies that have committed to renewable energy targets and other low carbon technologies. Therefore, in HIBISCS, we will explore green investments that align with the climate goals and continue to enhance our shareholders' value in such investments. And according to the IEA, the known technologies that we have today, they will not bring us to our net zero emissions goal. Yeah? Innovations are important to reach our climate goal. So against this backdrop, HIBISCS will endeavor to explore opportunities and support R&D activities that are climate-linked. And in due course, we will announce once a suitable green opportunity is identified. Now, can we move on to the next slide, please? Thank you. So this will be my final slide. As it is with our producing assets, HIBISCS will endeavor to operate our new assets that we would like to acquire in a climate responsible manner. And this slide shows the decarbonizing options that we will explore to reduce the emissions of our operations. And the measures will include evaluating decarbonizing strategies that will be guided by the marginal abatement cost curve approach. And decarbonizing options may include enhancing energy efficiency and optimizing production efficiency, which already we are carrying out in our existing production assets, increasing reliability of operating equipment such as the gas compressors, fuel switching for renewables for power generation, which we are already doing currently in North Sabah. We have solar as well as the wind turbine, reducing flaring, venting, and fugitive emissions. And this we have implemented through the installations of the leak detection and repair systems. And lastly, of course, to also consider investing in natural capitals. So that's it for now for the energy transition strategy. And I believe this is my final slide. So I'd like to hand over to the moderator to manage the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Weini. Now I would like to invite Dr. Ken to do a closing, closing remark on the presentation before we move on to the Q&A.
Sure. So thank you. Thank you for your attention through these presentation slides, and we hope you've had an opportunity to understand a little bit more about our company. And for those who have been following us, we hope you've had an update on what we're doing. I think, just to kind of say that we feel that we're in an exciting time. The crude oil prices are stabilizing, and they seem to be trending a little bit higher than what they were a year ago. And even though the pandemic is still much around us, and the impact of the pandemic is also around us, the oil prices seem to be remaining strong. So we hope that as the economy recovers and gets stronger, the oil prices will also strengthen further. So that's something that we are looking forward to. The company is also in a very important phase. We are transforming in size. the assets, the key point I'd like to say is, you know, we're now producing something like 9,000 barrels of oil a day. And after the Repsol transaction, oil production will go up, will take us to maybe around 18,000. And then with the gas also, we will be roughly at about 25, 26,000 barrels of oil equivalent a day. So a very substantial jump in the size of the company at a point in time when oil prices are getting strong. Okay, so we still, as a company, very, very conscious about our cost structure. And also, as you can see from the efforts we are making in the what I would call the ESG space, we are also keeping an eye now on our emissions, which are, you know, becoming more and more important. How you manage your emissions and ensuring you keep your climate change agenda, you know, top of mind, all very, very important considerations. So, you know, I think happy to take the questions and, you know, excited to hear some comments and what you think about the company.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank the whole, you know, HIBISCS team for making such a good presentation. I think a lot of things has been covered, but the audience listening to this, I would like to type in love this if so far you've been enjoying this presentation. Now, just from the points that I've gotten just now, I think, you know, the management is very professional. So the way they are saying the shocking facts are in a very calm way. So actually, I think a few very big points have been being shared. And maybe not everybody may appreciate how impactful it is. So correct me if I'm wrong, John and Dr. Ken as well. So this Repsol acquisition, based on what's been shared, is likely to double or more than double the reserves or the daily production or even the EBITDA of a company. Am I correct?
Yes, that is absolutely correct, Ming Tech. Yes, that's correct.
And this is coupled with very high oil price now. But of course, I have a few kindergarten questions to understand more about the business because I'm not from this industry. So maybe, John, I'll go first with my question.
Please, go ahead.
Yeah. So, Dr. Ken, I would like to know, because what's been shared so far is about how many, you know, oil rigs you have, how many reserves, how much reserves is there, what is the daily production, but how actually does a company generate revenue? I know you drill, maybe you actually, I don't even know what to say, like you drill oil, you extract the oil, like where is the money coming from? Who gives you the money? Who's your client? And what is it based on, the sales?
Okay, so we have oil platforms. We don't, in our industry, there's a difference between a rig, a drilling rig. A drilling rig is owned by a company like Belesto, and we have oil platforms. We have an FPSO, we have production facilities, let's say, okay? From these production facilities, oil is collected through what we call oil wells in the ground. We are owning these facilities, or we are operating these facilities in Malaysia. We are operating on behalf of Petronas. We are producing this oil from the ground. Oil is a natural resource, and we are transporting it to a terminal, and from that terminal or from our FPSO, from our facility, we are selling this oil. Our customer, it would be an oil trading company. In the UK, in the Anasuria field, it is BP. BP, one of the largest oil companies in the world. And in Malaysia, we sell our oil to a company, a trading company in Singapore called Trafigura. They will buy our oil. They pay us for our oil on a per barrel basis on the pricing that is actually, you see every day the oil prices is advertised somewhere, it's published somewhere, and you will be able to see it on all the different, Platts have it, all the different, Bloomberg will carry the oil price, all of this. So we will be selling it at a certain formula, and then we are paid a number of days later for that oil, okay? Our revenues are all, we transact in US dollars. So one of the things, you know, we are sad sometimes when we see the Malaysian exchange rate, the ringgit, going down in value against the US dollar. But on the one hand, we are sad because things are, you know, getting more expensive for all of us. But at the same time, for our company, because we are recording our revenues in Bahasa Malaysia and Ringgit, it means that we are getting more Ringgit for our US dollars. Okay, so we are trading in US dollars our oil. We are selling about 9,000 barrels a day. We don't sell our oil on a daily basis. We collect oil in tanks and we sell them in cargoes, in certain amount of cargoes. So each time we sell a cargo, it's a between 250,000, 300,000 barrels of per cargo. And we are selling about 12 cargoes a year, maybe roughly about one a month. Okay. So our oil price is coming from all the Bloomberg terminals and all that. So very transparent system. We're selling to big international traders. So they are our customers.
I see. So what is the name of the, like, if you go to the trading view, because I'm using that platform to see the oil price, it's sure, like sure. WTI US crude oil.
So yeah, look for Brent.
Brent.
Yeah, Brent will give us the base price. And then there is a certain premium or discount that is applied to that Brent, depending on the local quality of the oil. For example, oil in Malaysia, very high quality, you get generally a good premium. Oil in the UK, generally the lighter oils are also a good premium. But for us, our trading benchmark is Brent. Yes. Brent.
Okay. So because you only sell once a month, do you actually like time the market like a trader, like, oh, now it's a high, let's sell it?
I wish, no. If that was the case, we would be always on the upside, right, getting something. No, we plan our offtakes some weeks in advance. We sell our oil some weeks in advance, maybe six weeks to 8 weeks in advance. So when we sell it, we look for a refinery that's willing to accept it at a certain time, but everything goes through a trader. The trading company will do all that work for us. We each time a different refinery might be buying the oil, so there is a lot of different relationships to manage. So we just deal with two traders, one in the UK, one in Malaysia, and then we just trade with them, and they deliver the oils. They come and collect the oil with their own vessel, but they deliver it to the refinery that they've sold it to.
I see. So another follow-up question before I pass to John, and there's also a lot of very quality questions on the floor. I'll try to answer as many as possible because there's really a lot of questions that I think is really good to ask. So my next question will be regarding the volume, right? Regarding the volume, let's say if you see there's a very nice price, right? And we hear that, you know, Hibiscus can produce a lot. So correct me, you know, maybe you can share some light on my understanding. If you want to increase the production, is it guaranteed that you can immediately, like whatever you produce, you can sell it at a spot price? Or it also depends on whether there are buyers. Is there any difficulty in that regarding the volume? Do you have to adjust your production volume based on the demand? Or no, you can produce as much as you like.
This is a commodity. So there's always a price taker. There's always a taker for your commodity at a certain price. So when we are selling our oil through BP or through, I mean, mostly BP would, for example, they will call a tender with a few refineries, and they will tell the refineries in 6 weeks' time, there will be 300,000 or 250,000 barrels of oil coming from Anasuria. And who would like this oil, and at what price, what premium are you going to, they're only going to, the Brent price is the daily price. That's the you know, that's the benchmark. And they will say to you, they will say, please bid what you want. You know, so some will say, I will pay 10 cents more per barrel or 20 cents more per barrel, depending on how the demand and supply situation is. So, and then BP will present these bids to us, and we will say, okay, we'll take that one. Okay. That's what happens in the UK. In Malaysia, it's slightly different. We have what's called an offtake agreement with Trafigura. Slightly different. As far as an offtake agreement is concerned, as in the UK, we call it a marketing agreement. BP markets our oil, so we have to take that price. There may be some price movement. With Trafigura, it is just a fixed formula. We just have to tell them, such and such a date, please come and collect 250,000 barrels or 300,000 barrels from Lab One, and they will come, and there's already a pre-agreed formula. And we just look at Brent price, and we look at the Platts terminal, and we'll see the price, and then from the formula, we work out what they will pay us, and a few days later, they will pay us for that. Yeah.
I see. Well,
so it's not a matter of, we are not playing around with the volumes. We are producing as much as we can on a daily basis. We produce maximum every day, okay?
As long as the production is not being disrupted and the oil price maintained, the revenue and the revenue should be very stable. Am I correct to say that?
We have to also manage our costs. And if you look at our investor presentations, there are certain periods of the year we are doing more maintenance on the fields. So at that time, production might be a little bit lower, or our cost per barrel might be a little bit higher because of some maintenance ongoing. Normally, we do it in the summer months because the conditions offshore are better. And then in the winter months or in the monsoon months, we may not be doing so much maintenance. So maybe our unit production costs are lower in the winter months, but higher in the summer months. But over the course of the year, it balances out. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So over to you, John.
Thanks, Mengtek. Dr. Kenneth, the oil and gas industry, there's so many variables and so many, how would I say, parameters that an oil and gas operator should look at. Maybe if you were to simplify to the audience who are not from this industry, if you had three KPIs for your management team, what would they be? The three highest KPIs. Is it OPEX per barrel? Is it replenishment of 2P reserves? You know, what they are, just three.
If I had to pick three today, and I would say three of these KPIs 3 years ago would be different to three of them today.
Okay.
3 years ago, I would have said probably, like you say, OPEX per barrel would be very important. Uptime. Facilities uptime is very important. Mm-hmm. And 3 years ago, I would say the third one is reserves replacement. You know, if I'm producing one barrel today, I need to find one barrel today to keep my reserves replacement up. Today, I would say slightly different. I'm looking more at OPEX per barrel, very important. Mm-hmm. Cost is something we have to really watch all the time. I would be looking at, uptime, because facilities must be working. Otherwise, you can't produce anything. And today, I think more and more I'm looking at emissions. What are our emissions per barrel? Because it is becoming, in the UK, it is becoming expensive. If you emit a lot of carbon dioxide, you have to pay certain, I would call them in inverted commas, you have to pay certain carbon taxes. So if you're not cautious, you would end up spending a lot of money on that. So I think, and I think as we go forward, these are going to be probably the three KPIs I would prioritize. Yes.
Okay. So in a way, when we look at the entire listed company groups of companies in Bursa, right, you're the only pure play oil and gas company. Now, there's a lot of confusion when retail investors look at these differences companies. So in a nutshell, would it be fair for me to say that you are asset owners, your inventory is actually oil or gas in the ground, you make efficient use of your production facility and maintain as little cost as possible, and whatever fluctuations of oil and gas price is actually your revenue and your profit. Am I correct to say this?
Everything, yes, John, except the asset owner part. Mm-hmm. In Malaysia, Petronas, you know that little thing, yes. In Malaysia, Petronas owns the asset, but we manage it and we operate it. I think you understand we are paid in, okay. But in the UK, you are absolutely right. We are asset owners in the UK. The legal system in the UK makes it our asset. But in Malaysia, the asset is owned by Petronas on behalf of the people of Malaysia. And we are operating the assets, making a margin, and paid in oil. Okay.
Correct.
That's the slight difference between UK. But fundamentally, you are right. Exactly our
correct.
Business.
Thanks. And you brought up a very good question, because if you investors have read your annual report, just a follow-up question is that there is a concession-based system. and a PLC system. So maybe to the audience from who are not from the industry, in very simple terms, what is the difference between a concession system and a PLC system where ownership actually belongs to the national oil company?
Yeah, I think you've kind of said it very nicely, but a concession system, you are given a concession mostly for the life of the field. So you own it, you own the oil in the ground, it's your asset, and you produce it how you want and do the best for the field. It's almost like a kind of a, you know, do what you want to do to enhance your profit type thing. In Malaysia, oil is looked as a resource belonging to the country, as a natural resource belonging to the country, and each you are given a certain fee to manage it and invest in it. You are given a certain return, and you are supposed to use your investment, your capital, your knowledge to operate it on behalf of the regulator, in our case Petronas. And the oil never actually, you don't actually own the oil in the ground. That's the difference, really.
Great. Last question from me, because there's a lot of quality questions from the floor and I don't want to stop them from asking. So this last question is with regards to why brownfield and why you are different from a greenfield operator. You know, as you brought up in your earlier slides, there's a lot of geological exploration risks if you're a greenfield operator, and the risk actually comes down when you know the asset really well. Now, here comes the question. Will it de-risk, I mean, by 50% if you're operating with a known production profile of the field, comparatively to, I mean, ballpark, will it help? Because people get confused in terms of, you know, will you do a wildcat? Will you do or an infield appraisal? And how much de-risking are we talking about as compared to a greenfield operator versus a brownfield operator? A lot of people get that confused because when you look at, you know, drilling new platform versus that you're buying existing assets, what kind of de-risking are we talking about?
Okay. You know, we put up that chart, and I don't know if you mind if Andrew puts up that chart again.
Yeah, exactly. That is a very good chart. And I was teasing. Yeah.
Yeah. Can we put up that second chart, Andrew, the life cycle of an oil field? Yeah, this one.
This one.
Okay. Yes. So this chart actually answers your question. So what it's saying is, if you look at the top, the first thing says exploration, development, production. And when we are talking about brownfields, when we go into brownfields, Anasuria is a brownfield, North Sabah is a brownfield. These are brownfields are fields that have been producing for a while. They've already been producing for a while, and the production curve is already starting to decline. It would naturally start to decline. Okay, so Anasuya, and of course, when you are sitting with a lot of production, a lot of knowledge about that field, it's like, you know, the longer you know your car, a person, etc., you know how they're going to behave. It's the same with an oil field and oil platform. So the risk of, you know, of you having problems with your car or whatever, you know how this thing behaves. So you are going to be able to kind of predict when do you need to maintain. If you know every I don't know, 2 years you need to change the battery of your car, you change it every 2 years. And that comes from just having the car for a long time and using it, etc. So that's the kind of thing when you're operating a brownfield. You are looking at you know, all the how it declines, how the facility is working. You begin to understand how often you have to maintain your equipment, when you have to change the certain things, when you have to put oil here and do that there. So the brownfields there, the kind of the risk is mostly, like we say in the second curve, it's mostly about keeping your costs down, and it's about oil price. That's what's happening in that area. We have also a field called Marigold. Marigold is in the what we call the, it's actually a green field that's being developed. Okay, a discovery has already been made. There's no wildcat there. It's oil has already been found by somebody else. We bought over the field, and we're now developing it. The risk there is not looking for oil and finding oil. Oil is already there. We know that. We've appraised that field, etc. But we have to now make sure that when we run, when we execute the project to actually bring that field into production, we have got to put some facilities there, production platform. You saw the type of videos in the pictures, what we have to do. We have to put a small FPSO on this field. On Marigold, we hope it'll be an FPSO. So there we go to just manage our costs, make sure our project execution is good, and then we get it into production. And at that point, what you're hoping is the production profile is on the up, it's increasing. Okay. So and that would be something where it's like you bought a new car, you're running it in, you have to kind of learn, you know, what this means, what that means, kind of thing. So there is but at that type of field, the production rates are high. You are not, you know, you're not fighting a decline. You're kind of just kind of, you know, you're enjoying some good production rates. So that's the thing about these green fields. What we are not doing is doing wildcat exploration. That means, you know, let's just go and take $10 million and drill a well in my backyard and see whether or not. Maybe there is some. Yeah. Maybe there is some. You know, we're not doing anything like that. We are looking at places we know where we are looking at for oil where oil has already been found, in a sense. And we are then working in North Sabah. We know the field very well. We know the geology very well. In Marigold, a discovery has already been made. A discovery well was drilled. Several wells around the area have been drilled, so good knowledge of the reservoir, how they produce. So that's kind of like the difference, okay, about the risk. So this is kind of like an interesting chart. It's to be found. If you want to have a copy of this chart, you'll find it in our annual report. We have it every year in our annual report, just to kind of explain to people where our assets are in terms of risk, in terms of risk profile.
Great. Mengtek, back to you. I think lots of interesting questions.
Yep. So, Dr. Ken, can you give us an idea? How big is this Marigold once it's producing? Do you have any idea, or it's still like a mystery?
Yeah, No. We have Marigold. Marigold is Marigold has got something like 50 million barrels in the Marigold area. What we have proposed to the government to do is to kind of have a facility that can produce about 30,000 barrels a day, okay? 25 to 30,000 barrels a day. We will not, that is 100% production. We will not own 100% of the field. By that time, we hope to have sold down some equity interest in the field, maybe own about 40, 45% of the field. So that's the kind of Marigold production rates when the wells come in. These are high producing wells, around 5 to 7,000 barrels a day per well. Yeah.
Mm.
Okay. So this one, once it's being done in 2 years' time, even without factoring Repsol, it could like increase a daily production by 50%.
That was our base case. When you know that was our base case growth plan. You know, when you're going in for acquisitions, you are never sure whether you are going to be the party that wins the bid when you go in for an acquisition. So we need to always have a base case plan that gives us our growth, and that was our base case plan. Repsol is something that we bid for in the Southeast Asia region. We came out with the CRPS instrument that we had to fund something like that. And then we continue to work in the UK area with our base case plan. That's why we say, you know, it is the growth prospects of the company are quite good. We like this idea of being present in the UK and also in Malaysia. One, it gives us kind of like some diversity in terms of risk management. The other is the UK is ahead in the emissions, you know, the whole emissions type management and regime and all of that. So we learn a lot, actually. We are subject, you know, we've had to have a net zero policy there. So there are a lot of things we are doing there, which are probably, I would say, I mean, I need to ask Winnie this really, how long it'll take Malaysia to catch up. But in terms of, you know, what we're having to execute in the UK and commit to net zero agenda and all of this legally, you know, the UK have made it like a legal requirement to do so. We learn a lot, and we're subjecting ourselves to a lot of a learning curve there, which we hope in future we will be able to deploy or implement over here. So it's, you know, that's what's happening. But your question about Marigold alone would have the opportunity to give us a very, very, big upside to our...
Of course, that may require further investment. Am I correct?
Of course, yeah. Of course, that's correct.
But that's maybe 2 years down the road story, 2023.
Hopefully investment will start late next year. Yeah. Mid to late next year, yeah.
So just another follow-up question regarding the business model. Yi Jian here asked that there was a mention of Australian assets in the front. That's what is called the wildcatting. So is HIBISCS planning to invest significantly there to explore more? Or how did that come about, actually, that asset?
We bought the Australian assets in 2013. At that point in time, oil was $100, $110. And at that time, you couldn't buy production. You couldn't buy producing assets. So we bought assets that, you know, there was higher level of risk because we could not. When oil is $110, you can't buy a producing asset. At least you kind of, well, you can, but you're going to have to pay a lot of money for it. So we thought, okay, we would do something different at that point in time. Easier to buy a producing or buy an exploration asset and look for oil, okay, by taking more risk. But then in 2014, 2015, oil prices fell. When oil prices fell to $35, $30, it was actually cheaper to buy oil than to actually drill an exploration well. It became cheaper to buy discovered oil. So we bought Anasuria. Oil prices remained soft in 2016. We bought North Sabah. We bought North Sabah at around $35 oil price. Last year, we bought early this year, we bought the Repsol. I think we bought it roughly at about oil price was in the range of $48 to $55 in that range. So the timing of these transactions, you know, is kind of important.
Yeah. Mengtek, if you don't mind, I just want a follow-up question on that. It's actually very, in a way, I don't know whether it's difficult or is it easy for you guys to wait, because we've seen oil and gas companies, not necessarily exploration companies, hive off assets or buy assets at a high, and they're really suffering now, Doctor. So, you know, how do you actually come about to have that kind of discipline to really pounce when it is cheap? You know, we've got companies that actually bought assets at when price of Brent was at $100 a barrel and all that. How do you maintain that kind of discipline, if you don't mind me asking for that secret? You know, there's this FOMO, you know, everyone's chasing after the high oil barrel price. Everyone's trying to outdo each other. Everyone is procuring assets or equipment. You know, how do you maintain that kind of fiscal discipline?
We have a guy who has not said a word on this call yet, Deepak Thakur.
I know you're going to point to him very soon.
Yeah. So I think you better put Deepak on the line and he can give you the answer, because he never allows us to sell a...
So he carries a whip around, is it, Doctor?
Yeah, something
so he says,
like
no,
that.
No, Deepak, nothing above 60.
Deepak is very, very conservative with his, he kind of... I think you better tell them the secrets, Deepak. What's your secret?
Yeah. Hello. Hello, everyone. Hello, John and Ming. So as Ken said, I think this is one of our moat, I would say, competitive advantage. The kind of management team which we have, and we use our team to screen the opportunities. And we have a very robust investment framework to make sure, as Ken said, the timing of the investment is very, very important, right? And we want to, when we buy the asset and when we determine the purchase price, we want to make sure, even at a low crude price scenario, the cash flow is, positive, cash flow is robust. So, the kind of discipline we have in terms of, screening and doing the proper due diligence, not only for, the assets, it has due diligence in terms of the technical due diligence, financial, tax due diligence, all sort of due diligence. And I think then we take a holistic view and a final decision. So I think that is one of the reasons why all of our acquisitions, we managed to buy at a low price, at a time when crude price was low. And that's when you reap the benefit maximum to a maximum interaction.
Okay, just one follow-up. Sorry, Meng Tech, just one more follow-up. It's with regards to equity, because a lot of companies, when they buy high, they like to take on a lot of debt. And you guys prefer the opposite. You take on a lot of equity, but equity dilution. But the problem that I let me be a devil's advocate. Equity is given out in perpetuity, but debt has a finite time element. So, you know, other people will say that, why are you diluting us, especially for existing shareholders? Whereas the guys who say debt is much cheaper at you know, now with such low interest rates, why not take on debt rather than dilution of equity? So just like to hear your opinion, just being devil's advocate here. Then back to Meng Tech.
Okay, let me. I think, to be honest with you, initially, when we were buying some of the assets, when you buy counter cyclical, when you are buying assets when the whole market is crashing around you, when you're buying oil, when you go and buy oil and oil is like $27 or $35, no bank wants to lend you money at that point in time, actually. All the banks have got a price deck which says, you know, oil is going to go down further. And we are sitting down and thinking, you know, oil can only be going up. It must be at the bottom now, you know. So at that point in time, when you're looking for money to go and buy an asset, like when we were looking for Anasuya, money to buy Anasuya or even North Sabah, we were buying it at, I think Anasuya was what, $30, Deepak, at that time, $30, $35? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. No bank. In fact, let me just give you the story of Anasuya. When we started the asset, when we bought Anasuya, the first bid for Anasuya was $240 million or something in that range. And there were banks behind us, okay? Oil price went down. We changed our price. Us and Pink Petroleum, we changed our price. We dropped our price. Another bank left. We changed our price. We went down lower again. Finally, there were no banks left. And we brought the price down to 105, I think, Deepak. 105 million dollars for 100%. We were taking 50%. We had to pay 52.5 million for an asset which just a few months before was 240 million. Paying 105, okay? But the banks were not there. So then when we had no money to buy the asset, we also had no money because we bid the thing, but there was no bank. When we went to the meeting, we said, we don't have the money. Can you give us some loan? Maybe you can help us. So, no, we structured the deal in a way, okay, that allowed us to pay as we went with deferred consideration, contingent consideration, all this type of thing. So we structured the deal in a way that allowed us to with some equity, we were able to do it. So we've just been a little bit, if you are counter-cyclical, it's very difficult. You're counter-cyclical, very difficult to find the banks to support you when the oil price is dropping. But that's the time to buy the asset. If you study the industry and if you've done all your technical work, your due diligence work, you see the opportunity and you see that there are cost savings that you can make to bring the, you know, to increase the margin even further, then that's why maybe it's not so straightforward to get debt at the point in time when you're buying. When you're buying at the low oil price, it's not so straightforward. Yeah. So,
right, thank you. Okay. Meng Tech.
That's good to know, actually. We have a saying in Cantonese, banks, they like to lock you sao jie, means when it's raining, they want to keep the umbrella. When it's not raining, they'll lend you the umbrella. So that's what banks like to do.
Maybe that's why the last AGM, we gave everybody an umbrella. It's our gift at the AGM.
Symbol,
we
give
people symbolic. Umbrella. Yeah, we are giving the umbrellas away. Yeah.
I have two more questions regarding Hibiscus business model. And then I think maybe we want to move to maybe something else, right? Maybe cost or maybe some financial part, which is, I think, very excited to know. So Kevin Huang here has a question which piqued my interest as well. He's asking, does OPEC global oil production decision actually affect Hibiscus production rate, or you're actually free? Like, you OPEC, I'm not part of you.
So far, we have not been impacted by any of the OPEC decisions to reduce production. we have nobody has asked us to reduce or increase. We've been just left to do what we want to do. We are very, very small, you know. People don't see us as making a major impact on the oil price.
I see. So actually, somebody can dictate that? Government or somebody can dictate that?
No. In Malaysia, like I say, we are producing on behalf of Petronas. So Petronas is the regulator, and if they instructed us, I suppose we would have to be able to comply with some of their requirements. But so far, we have never been asked to do this.
Okay. And just to add, when OPEC Plus decided to reduce the production, the Malaysia share is also very, very small. If you look at it, it's just 20,000 barrels per day, right? So entire cut has been absorbed by Petronas.
Okay, so Petronas would take the hit. Okay, great. One more question would be, I see Hibiscus business model is actually a lot about buying up other people's assets that are already in production, that is already producing or close to producing, and then after that, optimizing that and making it better, right? So you try to buy at a lower price, and then after that, you benefit from several factors like oil price going up, you're buying it at lower valuation because that time oil price is low. And then you try to improve your efficiency so that you can produce more with lower costs, and you just manage it well. So would this be the business model or the focus or the modus operandi moving forward for Hibiscus? That would be the main focus?
Yeah, mostly that. We also look for opportunities. There might be some opportunities in the oil fields that the larger companies that we are buying from don't prioritize. So there may be some opportunities also. So you would have seen that in North Sabah, over the last 2 years, we have drilled 11 wells there, and the wells have been successful. The reason is, for a company like Shell that was previously operating that field, the type of targets we were going for were potentially within their global portfolio. You know, it was very, very small. But for Hibiscus, we are very focused. Even a small amount of oil, we would still drill for it if it made economic sense. So, yes, your description is right. We try to buy low. We try to look for opportunities to reduce cost on a unit production basis. We look at opportunities around the asset we are buying, so that if there's something that we can chase, we would try to do that. That's basically it. Yeah, that's the story. And of course, you can't count on the oil price going up. So you got to be comfortable that you can reduce your cost.
Okay. So maybe let me make a summary and correct me if I'm wrong on the Hibiscus business model. It's actually very much like a value investor, based on what I heard. You are looking for deals, and then it's like you're investing in properties or assets that is supposed to generate recurring income, and you try to improve it, manage it well, and buy when it's low, and try to hold, quality assets all the way up. So is that actually, the case?
Yes, I think, it sounds simple, but it's not so easy.
Yeah. Okay. John, over to you, right? If you see any, any like...
Yeah, I see a lot of interesting questions. And I know there's a lot of demand asking us to take the public questions. So let's start with... I'm going to scroll right to the top. Okay. This question, I'm pretty sure you get this. Yeah, there's too many. I'll just try to, aggregate them. Yeah. There's this one from, with regards to Brent oil price is now 76, but oil and gas counters price are so lagging. Why is there no demand? And I know it's a question that you might get a lot, Dr. Ken.
Actually, we also don't know that. In fact, this is more a Malaysian problem. Overseas, if you look at how oil counters have increased over the past, since the beginning of the year, some of them have seen substantial gains, tracking oil price. And if you remember one of the early charts I presented just now, where we show the graph of our share price or our market capitalization against Brent price, you'll notice that the gap is increasing actually. Once upon a time, we were tracking it really closely, yeah, but now we are falling behind. You know, today, Bursa Malaysia, the index was below 1500, and it's not been below 1500 for the longest time. So I am, and the Malaysian market has been a little bit, let's say, non-performing with all the different issues that are going on here. So, and I wish people will kind of look at our particular counter, mostly because we are dollar based. Mm-hmm. We are in a commodity business where the commodity prices seem to be increasing. The larger players are pulling out of this sector, meaning that there is going to be tightening supply going forward, at least for some years, until you have a replacement fuel or energy supply, kind of a solution. So for me, I am looking forward to a few good years ahead, actually. And we are so happy that we bought Repsol, and now we bought Repsol at a good time, beginning of the year is when we bid for it. And so we bid it at a different price than what it oil price is today. And interestingly, we also have the Marigold opportunity. So for us, it's really important to get Marigold going, because that is an asset we bought at. We bought Marigold oil in the ground. Deepak, just correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we paid about $1.20 probably, about that around $1.30 in the ground. That was our, exactly. So if you buy it, so we had no exploration risk. We bought 50 million barrels at about, between us, I think it was for $37 million or something.
$37.5 million,
and we took 50% of about 50 million barrels. So about $1.50 maybe is what we bought. So in terms of exploration risk, we took none. Mm-hmm. And now we can, if we want to have a production of, something like keep our oil, our costs below $30, we can spend probably about $15 development cost and another $15 operating cost, and we'll still be at around $30 a barrel. So when oil is at $60-$70, you've got a good margin
there. Of safety. Huge right. Margin of safety. What's the 2P for Marigold? Just refresh my memory.
About 50 million 100%, right, Deepak? Around there.
Yeah. Very 50 million data.
Yeah.
Okay.
2P.
All right.
100%. Yeah. So we have currently 87.5%, but we don't intend to finish with that. By the time we are in development, we will scale down our equity ownership in that. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So that's a very valuable asset to us. Very valuable, actually. You guys are, very good at analyzing companies. If you do the breakup value of our company, it is much greater than our market cap. Okay. Break up each of
the
these
sum
assets,
of parts. If we take it as a sum of parts and you add it all together, I've done that. It's the problem is my market may not appreciate it. That's why.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, Mengtek, I saw another interesting one. Actually, Viva T has a lot of questions.
A lot of great quality questions.
Very great questions. Yeah. I just hope
that we can answer.
Yeah. Probably I start with Repsol one first, is it?
Yeah.
So I'm looking at the Repsol one.
Or you can ask whichever that you were, selecting just now.
Yeah, I had one which is, I think, a very good question. What is the vision for HIBISCS? Is it going to be a major player in the future in terms of E&P? Does it aim to be a Shell? Or are you looking to be a mean and lean machine that takes over marginal fuels? Is that strategy going to be consistent in a way? And by the way, Deepak is holding the cane.
I think we are living in interesting times, okay? Because you see the opportunity in oil and gas, the majors are pulling out. There is a lot of deal flow at this point in time. So if you wanted to, you could be doing a lot of M&A work every other day, and if you're not focused. I think our discipline now must be to be extremely selective. We are mm-hmm. Not under any pressure to buy any assets. We are kind of comfortable with our growth through M&A. We have in-house opportunities to even double what we already have again. You know, we can add another 10,000 barrels a day in the UK over the next 2-3 years. Okay. We have the Teal West opportunity around Anasuria, which is also something that is going to increase the Anasuria asset. We've got Marigold. The UK is a growth area. We've got opportunities for cost reduction through the Repsol acquisition. One point I must say is that the Repsol acquisition, there are assets both in Peninsula, you remember Dr. Pascal mentioned, in Peninsula and in East Malaysia. The asset in East Malaysia is very close to our North Sabah fields. So there will be some synergy and some, you know, economies of scale if we can integrate some of the operations. So there is a lot of exciting, I would say, cost-reducing opportunities ahead. Okay, so there are lots of things we are looking at doing. We are not going to just be forever acquiring. We are also looking at diversifying. You remember Dr. Weenie's slide, a little bit about green investments, also going to be an area. And we will be very careful about it. The whole green space is a very large space. So we'll be very focused in what we're doing. We are researching the area we would like to target right now. And, you know, we would be happy if in about, let's say, between now and the next 4 or 5 years, we are sitting at around 30, 40,000 barrels a day. With the Repsol acquisition, we are going to be at least about 25,000 barrels a day, right? So if we can do Marigold and all of it and keep it at around 30, 35, it would be a good place to be. And it would be, we don't want to overload ourselves with debt and all of this. Just kind of understand that the market is also volatile. I mean, 2 years ago, nobody understood a big pandemic was going to come along and oil prices would even go negative for a certain amount of time. So I think just be, you know, prudent, but at the same time, a solid company, you know. That kind of thing. Solid growth prospects. Try to move into that dividend, consistent dividend paying space, and have a good governance. You know, that's really where we'd like to be.
Rondi has a question. Rondi, the guy behind the scenes setting this up as well. He said, and it's directed very specifically to Dr. Ken. He says, recently Rex International also bought Repsol's Norwegian assets. Just wondering about your thoughts on the thought process of why not buying Norwegian assets that will give an option for an IPO or dual listing in the Oslo Exchange. Norwegian investors are very familiar with oil and gas producing companies, and you know, might give you guys a better valuation or a better, you know, corporate image as well. What do you guys think?
I guess you really need to decide how many countries you're going to be in any one time. You know, we have looked at different markets in terms of listings and all of it. And you know, right now the Malaysian market knows us the best, I think. There are opportunities in the region. And also, you may go to Norway and you might be one of 50 or 60 companies. You can be in Australia, you can be, you know. But here, if there are people who want to follow an oil company, we would be one of the few ones in this part of the world, you know. So what we have to do is maybe to get ourselves up in size a little bit so that the, let's call it the international analysts can cover us. Right now, we're in that space where 300 million, 350 million market cap, just not in their radar. We need to be about maybe at around 500 to 750 million market cap. And then you start getting into, you know, the radar of the international analysts. And then you kind of get better coverage. Joyce, do you want to say anything about this? Because you've looked at listings here and there. Joyce, you're muted.
Sorry about that. Yeah, we did look at various listings around. We did look at Oslo. We did look at UK. We even looked at US at one time. And we also looked at Singapore. And then we kept circling back to Malaysia, I think. And then this is our, I think, most looking at where we're heading, most of our assets, our most valuable assets, and especially now with the transformational acquisition of the Repsol assets, most of the value is actually in Malaysia, in our Malaysian assets. So for now, we are keeping to Malaysia.
Mm. Okay, great. Meng Tek, any questions that you want to pick up? Because some are moving towards renewable energy already. So
I think we're going to split it also. I want to ask some questions on Repsol.
Please.
And after that, future revenue, upcoming 1 or 2 years revenue. Then after that, we move to maybe ESG. I think there's a lot of misunderstanding on fossil fuel now that maybe, John, you can clarify as well. So,
correct.
Yeah, I saw that the Repsol acquisition, right, a lot of this PSC is going to expire in around 10 years. So is there any possibility that this expiry will be extended? And my understanding is very big on oil and gas. Is there like abandonment costs where you need to like cement it or whatever the well when it expire?
Let me ask Pascal to, let me get Pascal into this conversation. Pascal, are you there? Yep.
Yep, I'm here. Okay. That's a good question. So as Ken said, the difference between a concession and a PSC is, first of all, a concession, essentially, it's yours for as long as you can produce oil, whereas a PSC has a fixed period. It's a contract, essentially. And in Malaysia, it's a contract with Petronas. So if you look at the North Sabah PSC, for example, that contract runs until 2040. So it's got a long life to go. So plenty of time to extract all the oil out of the ground for North Sabah. You look at the PM3 CAA, that has an expiry date of 2027. Yeah, so it's coming up fairly soon. Now, what happens is discussions are already underway by the current, still current owner, Repsol, with Petronas for an extension. Yeah? So as long as there's economic reserves in the ground at the time that this PSC would expire, Petronas typically will extend. Yeah? So you have a negotiation. You say, I want to extend for another 10 years. Petronas then will say, okay, that's fine. But you will have to do this and this and this. Yeah? So you have to drill more wells, or you have to try and find some more oil nearby or something like that. That's usually what goes into a contract negotiation. And then you get to add another 10 years and you continue producing. Okay. Now, on the other end, I was talking about one of the PSCs in the Repsol acquisition, which is essentially stopped producing already. Yeah, so there's no more oil to be produced there, and then it has to be abandoned. Now, the way that is managed in the PSC environment is Petronas actually makes you pay into an abandonment fund every year as you produce. So there's a formula for that. So it depends on how many barrels are left in the ground and how much you've produced that year. Are you planning to produce that year? That ratio will determine how much you have to pay. So you estimate how much the total abandonment costs are for this field. So you already mentioned cementing the wells in place. You have to remove the facilities. You actually have to physically take them back and scrap them in the yard somewhere, or you can sink the jacket structure onto the seabed, but you have to take care of what you put in place. Now, this abandonment fund builds up the amount that you need to abandon the field once it comes time to abandon. Okay, so in the case of this particular PSC, that's already happening. So this year, Repsol is already abandoning the wells, and then we have to abandon the facilities about a year and a half or 2 years down the line. Okay, but the money is already provided for.
So we do not need to worry that much on the cost for this abandonment. It's already been provided for in the past. Am I correct?
That's correct. Yep, that's correct.
A follow-up question on Repsol, this acquisition. there is, because one thing that made my saliva drop when I saw the slide is like Repsol asset contribution, CY2022 estimate is 558.8 million. That's like more than double your current 9 months EBITDA. So what is this assumption based on, the estimate?
Okay, so this is based on the oil price. So when you do an acquisition, you look at the value that you're willing to pay for this asset. Yeah? In order to do that, you forecast an oil price. So at the time that we put in the bid, we assumed an oil price based on what's called the Brent futures curve. Okay, so Brent futures curve is actually, all the traders in the world, they kind of project forward what the cost of the cargoes are going to be. And that is essentially, it's the best benchmark you can use at any point in time. Yeah. So that's what the oil price that we use in order to essentially forecast our value.
Andrew, slide 32, Andrew. One of your backup slides.
Yep. It's in the appendix.
Yeah, the Brent futures curve. Yep.
This is the Brent
futures. That's correct. Yeah. So when we're talking about next year, yeah, so you can see here the Brent futures, there's the yellow curve. So for fiscal year or calendar year 22, we're using $64.6 per barrel. Okay. On top of that, there's the slight premium that Dr. Ken was talking about. So that's what we use to determine the revenue. And then we're just forecasting forward the current cost of production. Yeah, and any CapEx investments, and what drops out in the bottom is essentially what is our EBITDA.
Are you able to secure by doing like financial instrument, like doing some futures thing to make sure you can sell at this kind of price, lock in the price?
Okay, so that actually does happen at times. So last year, when MCO really had its biggest effect on the oil industry, the oil price, Brent dropped down to $25 a barrel, I think. And WTI even went negative. So people actually couldn't sell. They had to pay people in order to take their oil.
Yeah.
That's correct. So in our case, we saw this coming. We saw it actually declining. And we looked at our production cost. Yeah? So for North Sabah, our average production cost is around $15 per barrel. Yeah? And we saw the oil price dropping and we said, okay, let's forward hedge some of our sales for the later part of the year, just in the worst case scenario where oil price drops even further. If it drops below our cost of production, we lose money. So you wanted to avoid that. So then we actually, with our trader, the trafficura that we sell the oil to, we essentially forward sold our oil at a fixed price. And then we knew we were safe. So you tend to do that typically in situations like this where oil price seems to be dropping rapidly. Yeah. So you try to hedge and say, okay, I want to make sure I'm safe and I stay above a certain level so I don't go cash flow negative. Or you do it when you make big capital investments. Yeah? So if you have a big capital investment, you know you got to take in debt, you got to pay off that debt. You want to make sure that you always have enough money to pay off the debt, yeah? So you don't go bankrupt. Yep. And that's so what you do hedging as well.
It actually hits your downside, but actually it also locks you from having further upside.
That is correct. Yes.
Yeah. Allow me one more question, John. On this Repsol, do we expect this EBITDA to drop as the production drop from Repsol? Will it decline over time? Are we expecting
like Dr. Ken was saying, as assets get older, production declines naturally. Yeah? So it depends on what you can do. If you can find more opportunities in the field to continue unlocking reserves, so drill more wells, then production will stay stable. So I'll give you a good example. When we bought North Sabah from Shell, the assets had been declining for about 7 or 8 years in terms of production. Mm. Yeah, 10 years before we bought it, it was producing 25,000 barrels a day. when we actually bought it, it was doing 14,000 barrels a day. Yeah. And of course, revenue declines with it and EBITDA declines with it, assuming oil price is roughly the same. And when we took it over, I think last September was, Ken, when we hit, we actually produced 20,000 barrels for a little while. Yeah? So we took it from 14,000 barrels back to 20,000 barrels. And that's by, first of all, very diligently doing our maintenance to make sure that the uptime of the facilities, North Sabah, it's as high as 98% at sometimes, but it averages around 95%. And the second part is to continue finding new opportunities to drill new wells and increase the production.
Understand. So this, maybe this is, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, maybe this is why it explains that you are able to buy it at about 1 billion, about 1 billion ringgit, this Repsol, 212.5 million US dollar. But in next year itself, you're expecting to make like half a billion EBITDA from it. So it's like taking 2 years EBITDA.
That's correct.
So because you're able to buy at a very cheap oil price, the valuation.
In general, when we look for opportunities, we set ourselves certain parameters, essentially thresholds that this acquisition has to meet. And one of them is payback time. IRR, payback time. Yeah. So
maybe
when we do...
Sorry? What's the IRR and payback time?
Oh, they're proprietary. Typically, we look at it has to be between somewhere around 2 or 3 years for payback time.
Wow. I mean, the CRPS limits were below 5 years, right? And the 12%
below IRR. 5 years and more than 12% IRR.
Yes, correct. Wow. So, yeah.
Okay, that's very good to know. That's a very good return. So, John, any follow up question on this?
What we have discussed? I'm just wanting to take a lot of the questions from the crowd because there's so many good questions. Yeah, one from Teo Chong. Will Hibiscus venture into LNG and renewable energy in the coming years? Now, I have a follow-up to that because Repsol now brings you guys into new territory. There's actually a lot more gas. And what are your plans? You know, sell it as LNG cargo or use it more for energy generation back onto the platform? What are your plans? Are you moving more towards gas or, you know, status quo?
Okay, so with the existing acquisition, so all the Repsol gas is tied to a long-term gas sales agreement. Mm-hmm. So we are taking over that existing agreement. And I think I mentioned in one of the slides that that asset is currently producing about 60% of the total gas consumption in southern Vietnam. Mm-hmm. So it's a significant portion. And that's a long-term contract. And any excess gas that Vietnam doesn't take, it gets produced straight to Peninsula Malaysia.
I see. Peninsula gas grid, is it, Dr. Pascal?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, that's correct. So the only place in Malaysia that where LNG is produced directly to an LNG terminal is in Sarawak.
Yeah. Okay,
so
great.
In Peninsula Malaysia, there are no LNG terminals, so there's no LNG production because all the gas is used directly for power generation. I'm sure.
Right. Thank you. Next question. Okay. This is from Rashidi Ramli. I don't know whether you can pose it up, Meng Tech. He says, give us good reasons why we should be Hibiscus long-term shareholders. Currently, your dividend payout is not attractive. I think I'm teasing out long-term capex plans from the management. You know, I think it's not a time for you guys to pay dividends. It's a time for growth. Is my opinion correct? And, you know, something to give Rashidi to bite on, actually.
I think we paid our first dividend earlier this year. And it was at a point in time where oil prices were starting to increase. And I think the directors were also happy that, you know, even through a tough year like last year, the company still came out, running positive cash flow operations. We took the reason why we showed a loss was only because we took an impairment on the Australian assets, but otherwise all the assets performed very well. And I think that gave the board a confidence that, you know, even in tough times, we were running some strong positive cash flows. So let's just say that if you believe in the commodity prices, you know, staying where they are or being reasonably stable above $65, and we are comfortable with our cost structure with these type of oil prices, then you know, obviously the company would be looking at having a dividend payout. But again, you know, there are going to be commitments for capex, etc. But you know, the objective for the company is to be a dividend paying company. That is the objective of the company. But it will be something. I mean, to be realistic, it is something that is tied to the oil price, because you cannot be, you know, what we don't want to be doing is borrowing to pay dividends. We yes. have borrowing capacity, but we don't want to do that, because then that we'll start demonstrating kind of, you know, not strong financial discipline. We must show operating cash flows first.
Okay. Right. Okay. There's a question from Vivati. There's many questions from him, and one last question from Theo later. So one of the questions that Viva actually asked was, how much of your cost moving forward will be cost recoverable by Petronas with the Repsol acquisition? I think he's referring mainly to the recent Repsol acquisition as compared to the North Sabah fields. Petronas has a very sticky view of having many experts in Malaysian assets. Do you view this as a risk moving forward?
Pascal is, you know, I think we have only two expats in our company so far. out of 500, I mean, no, we have very few expats. I mean, in Malaysia, we have a diverse group of people, but within the Malaysian asset operations, I think maybe two or three only, Pascal, working in the North Sabah asset. So I think... and you know, we are very proud of that, because we try to, there is fine Malaysian talent all around the world. Within the team, we have a diverse group of people, because we believe that diversity is very important, and we have assets internationally. In the UK, we have people who are British who work in the UK. So we have Australians who work for us. So we try to kind of have a big mix, but within the Malaysian asset itself, we understand it's a cost recoverable asset. We should be, you know, trying to minimize where there is local talent. We should try to use that if it's more cost effective. So, but because we are not just in Malaysia, we have a pool of expatriates who kind of give us a lot of know-how and experience as well. So it's a kind of a mix. And within the company, we work as teams. We mix everybody up together, so we have that sharing of knowledge. But we do understand that within the Malaysian environment, we should minimize the number of expats to reduce cost recoverability issues. Yeah.
Okay. Just one last question. Please, Dr. Pascal, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to add that the key to cost recovery with Petronas is good governance. We've demonstrated that we're quite respected by Petronas in that regard, so we've had very few issues up to this point, and we intend to do the same thing in the Repsol asset.
Yeah, great to hear, Dr. Pascal. I've been up in the MPM boards as well. They're not very kind to expatriate crowds, actually. Last question from me for Teo Chong. He asks, Repsol bought Talisman at a premium price, perhaps in 2014, 2015. Why is Hibiscus acquiring Repsol today, even though Talisman bought it at a premium?
I think many assets come to the market. You decide how you value the asset, and you put in a price for the asset. And if... and we never want to be the highest bidder for an asset. Okay, we normally would like to be the most likely bidder that the vendor looks at as being able to close the deal. Okay, because there are a lot of people who can excitedly put a big price there, and then later on can't complete the deal because, you know, there are no banks at that time to support them or something like that. So what we try to do is to be realistic in our assessment of the situation, And we also try to present a kind of a confidence. We try to kind of get the confidence of the vendor that we would be a good bet for them to complete the deal. Okay. Mm. So, and slow, and also one thing that has helped us is we have had a track record in Anasuria of closing that transaction with ExxonMobil and Shell. Then in North Sabah, we closed the transaction with Shell. And the more transactions you close with the larger companies, the more the other larger companies feel these are serious people.
I see.
Because if you know, if you are a fly-by-night guy, you are not going to be entertained much by all these large companies. So the more the track record you have and you protect the track record and you respect the guy who is the vendor, I think the more credibility you build for yourself going forward. I think anything to add to that, Pascal?
No, that's exactly it.
Yeah.
So when we win a bid, we win it on other factors than our
price
consideration. Yeah.
That's a very good insight, actually. Yeah. Thank you. Mengtek, back to you.
So I've got a question from Melissa here asking about what is the current cost per barrel for the company to produce?
Okay, I need to bring CY here because I want to make sure he's still on the line.
Okay.
Okay.
With his tie, is it, Dr. Ken? With his tie.
I don't know. CY, where are you? Are you still around there? Yeah, you've been very quiet. Yeah, yeah. So maybe you can help us with the unit costs. Yeah.
Well, the cost per barrel for two assets in the UK and also in Malaysia, they're quite different. But they range around $20 per barrel. So we try very hard to operate within the level, because if you do that, really, then if oil price being a bit more volatile from time to time, we are quite confident that we can keep our profitability very sustained. So that's really mentioned earlier by Ken as well. We try very hard to maintain our cost at that level, to a low level, and that's what we target.
So it's about $20 now, and you try to maintain it around there.
If you look at the history of our announcements, we have been doing that quite successfully. But from time to time, you will see some spikes because of our planned maintenance activities in both the UK and in North Sabah as well. But by and large, average over a particular year, it is roughly around that. And in recent times, actually, we have gone even below 50 in some quarters. So we have been quite successful in maintaining our cost to a low level.
Okay, that's good to know. So just wondering, for Repsol acquisition, what is a Repsol assets cost per barrel now?
Well, it's a little bit, because cost per barrel in this case, you're talking about both the gas and oil in Repsol, so they have both. So naturally, it is a lot lower than what we have right now. But if you just look at the oil, it's not too far away from what we would expect from what we currently have. So not too far away. But if you look at the combined asset, it is a lot lower.
It's less than 15 on a combined.
Less than 15.
Less than 15.5. Yeah.
That's right.
Even at a level of oil price around 30 something, we can expect like Hibiscus can still be profitable.
Oh yes. I think that in last calendar year was a classic example. Actually, I think Pascal mentioned about us hedging, and we did hedge at that point in time in the early part of last calendar year, and when oil price was really quite low, was below 30, and we did manage to sell between 30 over to 40 odd over the rate cost of the entire calendar year. From both assets. But if you look at our financial performance, we have been profitable quarter on quarter. And we managed also to save enough to pay dividends early this year.
Okay. So I've got a question, which is regarding finance. So that's good that you're here. Because I see that in the slide, one of the acquisition, the funding for acquisition is not completed yet, right? There's been the prior placement, am I correct? Prior placement, CRPS, is it?
Yes, that's right. That was concluded actually. Yeah, there you go. The CRPS exercise, the tranche, there are two tranches, there were two tranches, one and two, that was concluded last November. And our net proceeds, if you see from the chart, the second column, you will see that we have close to about $48 million net from that exercise. Now, some of them have been utilized to pay the deficits that we had to do so during the closure of the PA. So that has been done. And we have also substantial amount remaining in that from that particular initiative. But of course, we are also looking in the debt space for Repsol, which we are in the midst of trying to get across the line. So we have a little bit of time to do that. So that's what we are focusing on at this point.
Sorry. Actually, my main thing that I'm looking for is there any more potential dilution? Because as far as I know, most of the shares has already been issued. So if fully diluted, there's about like 2 billion shares. Am I correct?
Well, at this point in time, the conversion of CRPS is close to 97% or 98% already. 98% the conversion, yeah, close to that. It's very, very high. So we have so all those will have been reflected in the share capital that you see currently in the market.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And would there be, because bank borrowing plus the fund that's already in the target from 1 January and internally generated funds, which will be some, maybe 100 million ringgit.
Perhaps, yeah.
So add up is 300 million plus the, I think there's still a few hundred million missing, right? Whether the bank will lend you?
Well, there will be some amounts from debt financing, but you must also understand that the effective, I think it might have been missed earlier, but the effective...
It's in the first column. It's in the first column, Siwa.
There you go.
In the chart.
Yeah.
Yep.
So the effective date of the transaction is 1st Jan 2021. So what that means is all the net proceeds and the net gains from the operations of the asset will accrue to HIBISCS upon completion. So if you can imagine that the oil price now is hovering around $70 odd, and the assumption that we took for our, what do you call that, our assessment before we acquired the assets were a lot lower, based on the Brent at the point in time. So if you can just compare that, the gain coming from this particular adjustment that will accrue to us since 1st January 2021 should also help us quite positively.
Okay. So the need to have the subsequent tranche of prior placement of CRPS may not be that high, am I?
Is it? It would be unlikely at this stage, if you ask us.
Oh, so maybe unlikely to have any at all.
Yeah.
Oh,
I think what I would say is this: most likely, if there's any other acquisitions, we may have to issue some equity. But this acquisition, there may be other sources of funds to close the transaction. I think that would be the right thing, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. If we are, we able to
I was referring to just Repsol. So
he's just alone, referring to Repsol.
For Repsol alone, it would be unlikely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm. Wow, for that's Repsol very good alone to know, because I think like what a lot of people are worried is there may be further dilution, right, in order to complete the acquisition. But I'm very delightfully surprised, you know, that actually, based on what it is now, there is no need. Okay.
Mengtek, also right. The other thing, I don't know whether Dr. Kenneth or CY is comfortable to divulge. A big chunk of the private placement has been taken up by themselves as well. So
we and I don't want to say big chunk, but it was maybe about in the oil field, it's quite a small number.
Yeah. No, because I think Mengtek, why I wanted to bring up this point is that when there is private placement and the owners themselves are accumulating, then in a way, my opinion or my interpretation of that, there is they have faith in the future of the company and they are bearing that risk as well as that dilution as well. Yeah, that's how I see it. I may be wrong, but that's how I see it.
But actually, correct me if I miss out on something. The EBITDA next year is supposed to be around 700 million, but there's only 2 billion shares. So it's like 30, 40 cent EBITDA per share.
Yep. Yeah. If the audience got the hint from what Meng Tech just said, I think they're still awake.
Did I miss something here?
And just to note on that, that EBITDA, I think Pascal mentioned earlier that EBITDA the guidance just from Repsol, that was based on a Brent assumption of just under $60. Mm. So that was what we have used for our assessment.
Wow. So, not expecting big dilution, and next year will be a great year. Okay, good. I got that hint, right? Okay, good. Rondi here says that, you know, this has been a very power-packed and insightful session. We are here for 2.5 hours. We are not ending yet. I'll ask a few more questions before we end. But really, thanks everyone for tuning in. You know, this is so crazy. It's been close to 2.5 hours, and we still have 350 packs. It's like 11 p.m. now. You know, so thank you, everyone. I think, you know, this is a very powerful session. I myself am very pleasantly surprised with what I learned today, right? So type in, give us a thumbs up or a love, or type in love if you truly enjoyed this session. John, do you have any other questions before, you know, I ask my last few questions?
No, I think just go ahead, Meng Tech, because I want to get opportunities to guys on the floor to ask as many questions as possible as well. Meng Tech, go ahead, please.
So if you can find some, you know, interesting questions.
Yeah, there's one that I think warrants.
What is the question?
This is from Viva, actually. It goes to
Viva's question.
Yeah, Viva's question. Marginal fuels is a very attractive space right now. How do you guys view the competition? Guys like Vestigio, Jade Energy, EnQuest, or even, I don't know if you consider Mubadala as a competitor. I know they are quite sizable in the Middle East, but here they are starting to acquire some, you know, pretty attractive assets. Where do you see yourselves in this sea of what we call lean operators?
I think so far, we are not falling in love with any particular asset. We kind of like what Deepak said, you know, we have a set of investment criteria. We bid and we kind of do a lot of work around the asset. We are looking for assets now that make a step change to the company. And if we are buying a small asset or we are bidding for a small asset, it means that there is a bigger picture behind it. Okay.
Understand.
It's kind of to get a foothold in a country or whatever it is. So that's kind of the philosophy at this point in time. So this is a really big industry. We came in only 10 years ago. The industry found some space for us. Mm-hmm. So we're not concerned about all the other parties, because, you know, each person has their particular competitive strengths to win particular assets. Okay. And sometimes somebody will see, as you know, John, someone will look at a seismic interpretation very differently to how we look at it, right? And
precisely.
So they might be a bit more aggressive when they buy it. So everybody has their own view on that asset. And so we put a certain valuation on an asset. And if we lose it at a certain price, we are happy if somebody else won it at a more expensive price. There have been assets like this where we have bid and we have even been in a situation where I think for one particular asset, we were, I think, 1/4 the price.
Wow.
Of the winning bid. We were 1/4 the price of the winning bid. But we didn't cry about it. Okay. We just said somebody else sees that differently to us. Maybe we missed something, but somebody else seen. But looking back, I don't think we missed too much. That was some years ago. But looking back, I don't think we missed too much. Okay.
Yeah.
So I think you would have seen deals in Malaysia. You know, PTTP paid some money for Murphy.
Correct.
At that point in time, everybody thought, well, this is a high price. But since then, they have made some big discoveries. So maybe looking back on it, it's a good deal. So you just don't know how different people see it. You have a geologist who knows a particular area. They might look at it. And all I'm saying, there's enough space for everyone. And we, as long as you kind of know what are your limits for a particular asset, then I think you either, like we said, we don't want to always be the high bidder. We want to be the best value bidder for the seller,
Be willing to walk away if it's not attractive, lah. I think that's the message you're trying to say. Yeah.
That's correct. Yeah.
Last question for me. And I think this is something that I personally have come across as well. The South China Sea is always a very disputed area in between the few nations that surround it. It doesn't really come up in the press. What are your thoughts on the conflict of the claims within the South China Sea, and does it really impact Hibiscus and PSC sovereignty of Petronas on those assets, actually? How do you guys manage that risk, actually? Or you don't think it's a risk at all?
So far, I mean, there are lots of assets around us that would be at risk if we were at risk. Okay. Yeah. So I would say the whole country would be at risk if we are at risk. That we are not in any extreme place or any disputed waters, and even in the maritime border areas with Vietnam, we are managed in a CAA, in a collective arrangement.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think it would be a very pretty serious situation for the country if we are considered being at risk, actually.
Great. Okay. Great.
Yeah.
Meng Tek.
Yep. So I have three more questions. Then I think let's call it a night, which is a very powerful night. I think this sharing for retail investors really can help us understand Hibiscus business much more in depth, especially for people that are not from the industry. So one of the common perception that people have on oil and gas company is, it's dirty. It's not environmentally friendly. Let's go for solar. So I think there may be some misconception there, especially now that Hibiscus is going into bought Repsol and almost half the production is coming from natural gas. I think, guys, if you're listening to this and the team, Hibiscus team, if you can correct me if I'm wrong, I think the life cycle impact, right, John, you can add in, of solar is actually quite high in terms of environmental impact, because that's my final year project in my university. And natural gas is actually quite clean in a way. What's your thought, Dr. Ken, or maybe John, you want to chip in?
I've always been a big believer of natural gas. I wouldn't elaborate my thoughts. I would like to hear Dr. Cano's thoughts, actually.
I think we have to understand that let me just say that every part of the world must look, in my view, at the renewable sources of energy that fits its particular set of situation. Okay, if you are in the desert and land is not a big issue, you have very strong irradiance, is what they call it. You have good good sunlight and you have long daylight hours, etc. Solar could well be a good solution for you. And in the same way, if you are in the latitude of about 40 degrees north or 40 degrees south, where you have got strong winds blowing a lot of time and all of that. So wind can provide some power, a renewable source of power for you. So there are all these different options. In our particular situation, we are in an area where solar is, we maybe get 6 hours of real sunlight in a day. There's cloud cover, etc. But we have been blessed with a lot of gas, okay? So we have got to find a way to use the gas, but reduce emissions related to the gas. We've got to minimize emissions, and that's our particular situation. And this gas belongs to all the citizens of the country. And why should we not find a way to use that, okay, first? and supplemented with other forms also of suitable energy. So I'm also a strong proponent of using the natural resources of the country as much as possible. So if gas is one of them, and then we should use it, okay? And the important thing is this, and Dr. Vini mentioned it just now, eventually electricity is going to be the main form of energy, but that electricity comes from a primary energy source. What we have to make sure is that primary energy source, be it solar or wind or gas or coal or whatever, the emissions from that from the generation of the power from that primary energy source must be clean. That is what the whole net zero agenda is about. What we have to be smart as a country is to have a strategy that achieves that objective. My big pride in all of this is that actually when I see how Sarawak is actually thinking about this as a state, they've got the hydroelectric power. They're now trying to think how to use the hydroelectric power to make a hydrogen-based type energy system and all of that. So they're kind of like looking at the whole value chain to deliver clean energy, and they're trying to optimize the natural resources around them, which is hydro for them.
Okay. That's right.
So they're doing exactly that. They're coming up with something very integrated, and that is something really good. I think there is some work to do in West Malaysia about that, is what I'm thinking. But luckily on West Malaysia also, in West Malaysia, we also have good gas. Okay. So we need to be smart about how we use the gas and clean the emissions from it and just be a bit more responsible about that. Winnie, would you like to add anything around what I've just said?
Yeah, I think, Ken, you pretty much sum it all very nicely. But I think what I wanted to include here is that my background is actually 15 years serving the Ministry of Environment. Yeah, and I think from the country's point of view, when we look at energy, we are looking always at the energy trilemma. Yeah, there's a triangle. So we're always looking at affordability, security, and also environment sustainability. And I think very important part of all this is that we are using the resources that are endowed to us and we use it responsibly. I think these are very key words to us. And this whole entire net zero pressure on us, actually, if you read the report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC report that was actually issued back in 2018, our window to close this 2 degrees Celsius, or rather the 1.5 degrees Celsius, is actually less than 10 years. So meaning to say that whole entire net zero, it is actually a very real thing. If you look at what's happening in terms of the climate change that we're experiencing, it is all very real. So that's why I'm very proud that, you know, today in HIBISCS, you know, Dr. Ken just mentioned that one of the key KPI we're looking at is really on the GHG. On the entire ESG spectrum, I know there are questions on it. I might as well take the opportunity to explain it now. Actually, for HIBISCS, the governance side, there has not been any issue. If you look at the slides that was actually shared just now, you know, the reason why we are in the FTSE for good, the reason why we are actually recognized by Bursa and also the MSWG is because of our very high and transparent disclosure. And on the social side, we have also always been, I've noticed, even though I've only been in HIBISCS recently, you know, I've noticed that they've engaged their staff and taken care of their staff very well. In the past 18 months of COVID, it has been very trying times, but you'll be amazed to learn how much we've tried to engage the staff to actually take the mental pressures of them during this work from home scenario. Yeah, many staff has actually sacrificed their time in terms of actually, you know, having to leave their family when they go on the platform. They actually have to be locked up in some hotels for much more longer when they actually, you know, move offshore and come back. And that's a very huge sacrifice that the staff have made. But I think the elephant in the room here is the GHG emissions. And that's why today I'm here on board. We have the sustainability policy that has actually been just passed by the board. So we are looking at decarbonizing. We are looking at having more gas in our portfolio. All these are really part of the solutions to the energy transition, including the conversation about Tesla's cars that I can see here. Mm-hmm. You know, that the answer to this here is that don't be so hung up about EVs, yeah? but be hung up as well about the electricity that is going to clean up, you know. So it's no point if you're just going to pour in more and more coal. So Malaysian government, if you look at the Energy Commission, they are going to, you know, Tenaga, I'm proud of them. They have already committed that there's no more new coal after this, yeah. But besides that, what else must we do? So like what Dr. Ken is saying, the electricity that we produce must be clean or must be green. Thanks.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Dr. Winnie. Actually, great that you brought up the energy. There's always this dilemma because a lot of people just look at the hype, EV, green energy. But then behind all this, there's actually economics. There's actually a lot of things that are, how would I say, not very well presented. Like, for example, rare earth materials for batteries. People don't talk about them enough. People don't talk about carbon sequestration. And all these kind of things are actually, you know, hidden behind the limelight. And people just look at the hype. And I'm glad that you brought it up. It must achieve harmony rather than just, oh, it's good because it's EV. You know, that's not necessarily true.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. So I guess we want to conclude this session. I have two questions so that the viewer can bring something back to remember the whole conclusion. So one will be, what are the risks, in your opinion, of investing in hibiscus? What are the curveball? What would like really throw us off and make us like panic or something that keeps you up at night? Like, what is a worry or risk? Maybe give one or two. Yeah. So that is my first question. Then after that, I'll ask the final one.
I guess risks are things that you cannot control. The one thing that we cannot control are oil prices, okay? So I think, and you can see sometimes something like the pandemic and all of a sudden the whole oil price market, you know, took a big turn. So I think that is something which is obviously you can, and sometimes these things turn so fast. The volatility now in the world is so quick. We are not so worried about regulatory stuff now because we feel that we are in Australia, we are in Malaysia, we are in the UK. All of these places, we feel that the regulatory environment is reasonably fair. It's balanced. In other words, if they're going to change the rules, they give you some time to think about it. You know, they're not going to do things overnight. You get proper kind of notice. So that's not the big worry. I think the main factor that, you know, that we really cannot control is oil price. That's the one thing. And you know, the pandemic is something that just demonstrated how quickly these days, you know, all of a sudden no planes are flying and nobody wants to buy jet fuel anymore. And of course, high quality crudes like tapis in Malaysia and all of that gets affected, of course, you know. Yeah. So it's these things, actually, things you can't control is what we're concerned about.
Oh. All right. Final question. What would you want people to remember about hibiscus? Like, if they can only take back one thing, what would you want them to remember about hibiscus as a company?
I think what we'd like them to take back is the fact that we are a transparent company. We basically let you know what we are doing. We try to give you as much information as we can. And we understand that different people have risk appetites that are different. But so we want you to clearly understand when you are taking a bet on us by buying our stock, what you're actually buying into, what you know. And we spend a lot of time on all our collateral material, trying to make sure that people understand in as simple language as possible. So I think that's the most important thing. You know, transparency means that you are not concerned about your governance. You can be transparent because you feel your governance level is high. That's what we like people to think about it.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ken. I think the fact that you and your team spent 3 hours with us answering all the questions. Of course, we couldn't ask all the questions on the comment because there's just too many. This is the Facebook Live where I had the most questions before. But it's been like a really, really informative session, especially for me. I myself learned a lot. Thank you very much, Dr. Ken, and the entire Hibiscus team for sharing so many things with us. The audience type in thank you, right, at the comment if you really learned a lot today, right? John, yep, any last words?
No, I share the same sentiment as you, Mengtek. I think having a high-powered team, can you imagine if you have to pay them man hours, Mengtek, to just be 3 hours with us? The man hours added to answer that. And I think it goes to show the kind of integrity as well as the transparency that Dr. Kenneth and his team actually uphold. We thank you, really, for helping us.
No, thank you very much for hosting us and giving us the opportunity. It's been a pleasure, you know, really. And thank you so much to all of you. Thank you.
Okay. And thank you to the team. Friday night, you know, I just remembered, and they spent 3 hours with us. Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Luckily, everywhere is closed.
Yeah. Consider this as an alternative to your movie.
There you go.
Yeah.
Okay.
Bye-bye, guys. I'm ending the broadcast.
Good night.